So thank you very much. So based on the timing, whether we should start or we'll wait for some more time, the moderators can decide.
I'm in a meeting. I will be only at 1:30.
So Dr. Tin is just joining.
Okay. So Dr. Manisha from Apollo sent me one video. She actually she felt it's a very good COVID video song. Probably you can stop anytime. I'll just start that one.
You can help.
If you wanna help me with anything at all, you need to wash your hands.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha.
You can help. Got a couple dirty hands. You can help.
So anytime we can stop Shiva and Marissa.
You can help. It's a fact some people get sick when they come to see their doc. Your hands are full of nasty germs. It's really not a shock. You can help. Your hands can really spread disease. You can help. Sure, do us good. To do what you should, you can help. When you reach to shake my hand, I hesitate and think of what to do. I know your hands are probably not very clean. Not being mean. Don't pull me in a bind, Doc. Don't try to shake my hand until I know that doctors wash their hands across the land. You can help. If you really want to help your patients, you can help. You should do us good to do what you should. You can help.
The doctor, Tin has also joined. I think like we can start now. Probably we'll start with Dr. Tin's presentation.
So, good morning, Dr. Tin. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Yeah, it's nice to see you. Where are you? Your background is it virtual background or still you are at a beach only?
Yeah, it's a background on the screen, but I'm still in the market life.
So, we have been going on this session for the past 1 week, and we are excited to continue for next couple of weeks also with the limited sessions. So this is the last day of this particular season, interventions in the congenital heart disease, Dr. Tin. And today we have very good moderators, Dr. Bharadali and Dr. Shivkumar, and also we have panelists there. So I request the moderator to introduce Tin and then proceed the sessions. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Shiva.
Thank you.
Hi, Dr. Tin. It's a pleasure to see you smiling. Dr. Tin is one of the most versatile Asian pediatric interventional cardiologists, one of the most dynamic persons in Asia, conducts meetings very frequently. And is very well known throughout the entire international circuit. We look forward to hear the most interesting case from you, Dr. Tin. Please go.
Hi, Shiva. Hi, Bharat. Hi, Nagesh. Thank you for giving me the chance to share my experience in the interesting case. My case today is the 3 months patient. Treatment ovation. The body weighs about 4.5 kg. In her history, it's a failure of try, and the patient was diagnosed the coronary fistula at 1 month old. And but everything is normal. Examination, the fetal size looks okay. But continuous murmur at the lower left. And X-ray, we can see the cardiomegaly and increased pulmonary vascular markings. and EKG is a sinusoidal. And let me start with the echo. You can see the little bit dilated of the LV and LA. And you can see the coronary fistula appendage to the right atrium with it seems the two A6 bones. But on soft A6 view, you can see the huge dilated of the right coronary artery. And you can see it's the training into the RI. I think it's two A6 bones over there. A little bit separate of A6 bone. And subcostal view, you can see also, we can see the right coronary artery is related and two A6 bone to the right atrium. And echo, we conclusion on echo that the sinus, situs solitus, and huge the right coronary artery related right coronary artery fistula to the RA. The RCA root, the diameter about 10 mm, is very large. And we have some aneurysm on the weight of the trainees to RA. And there are two A6 bones, about 2.5 and 1.6 mm connected to the RA. And normal left coronary artery. And dilated of the LV and good LV function. On CT, we can see the same, the huge dilated RCA. And taught us to train it to the RA. But you see, there is can see the native coronary right coronary artery arising from the dilated part, proximal part of the RCA, but it looks normal. And here also, you can see the two trainees into the RA, one about the 2.2 and one is smaller. And MACD, we conclude that is the dilated proximal RCA. The distance from the ostium to the orientation of the native coronary artery, right coronary artery, about 14. The multiple aneurysm, about 10 to 15 mm. And there are two A6 bones at the right atrium, about 2 and 1.6. And a normal left coronary artery. And the diagnosis is the right coronary artery fistula to RA. But the problem is a huge related RCA and failure of tri. And let me discuss the indication for closer. This patient should be close the fistula or not. We think it's this high flow coronary fistula, dilated LV and increased pulmonary vascular markings. We did the right heart cath also, and we see the QP per QA is about 2.7. The second thing is a huge dilated RCA and failure of tri. Third problem is a small baby. The body weight is about 4.5 kg. And my question is, should we close the fistula or we can wait until several months later or sometime? What do you think?
Dr. Tin, you have given the points for me. That will indicate a closure, a large shunt with significant growth failure. I assume there is a significant cardiac failure as well in spite of diuretics. So I think it becomes an indication for an intervention. And probably in your safe hands, the judgment between a surgical versus an interventional closure might be a better choice. We totally agree that there is a indication for an intervention right now.
Yeah. How about you, Bharat?
Yeah, I would completely endorse what Shiva said. But at the same time, I must say that dealing with coronary fistulae in a child who is just 3 or 4 months weighing 4.5 is technically a demanding procedure and should not be undertaken unless you have adequate experience and expertise in dealing with this particular pathology.
Yeah, we have the same situation with the problem with the technical issue when we try to close the small baby. But I do agree with you, this patient is an indication for fistula closure. And what did we do? We put a 5 French fibro artery. Remember, patient just 4.5 kg. I think the 5 French is best one. You cannot use 6 or 7 French. 5 French for the fibro vein, and we use heparin. The 4 French pigtail for the aortic root angiography. And what you see? You see, when we do aortic root angiography, we see the huge dilated right coronary artery. But you see the fistula is very tortuous, and there are multiple aneurysms to the entrenched to the RA. On the lateral view, maybe you can see more complicated the tortuous, but what we see? We see the huge dilated RCA from ostium. Native coronary artery arises from the dilated proximal part of, but it's normal. The tortuous fistula and multiple aneurysm. And the SH1 really is not clear. On CT, on echo, we think it's two SH1, but on angio until now, we could not see clearly. And what can you suggest, Andy? Well, what the morphology is enough for we proceed the procedure, or we need some more angulation or some technique to get more clearly for the image.
Two questions that come to us is the number of exit points that you already pointed out, and the second thing is the number of branches that are arising from this fistulous tract, and both these will be obtained by taking an arteriovenous circuit and getting a balloon to occlude the distal exit and then make a repeat angiogram through the proximal entry. And that might give what are the side branches that are arising, what is the landing zone for the device, and third will be the number of exits.
Yeah. We don't use the balloon test. Normally, we don't use balloon test. We try to make the AV loop, and we push the long sheath, maybe 7 French, crossing the fistula, and we do angio again. And you can see with the sheath crossing, we do angio again. You see the native right coronary artery is looks separate from the fistula, and there are almost no branch is on the way of the fistula. And I mean the fistula is isolated with a native coronary artery. And the landing zone for device, I think maybe we have a long landing zone. You can put device anywhere because there are no branches on the way. What do you think?
I think closing the proximal entry would be good enough. I'm not so sure whether you would then like to even close the distal point of exit. I would be happy just closing it where you have shown that X1 should be good enough. I don't know whether you want to close both point of entry and exit, but I think point of entry closure should be okay from my point of view.
The only thing is we should take a very secure device, because on a X plane you are having 3.64 and Y plane you are having 5.3. So preferably, we need to choose a device that is sufficiently larger that it doesn't embolize into the aneurysmal sac. And if it embolizes into the aneurysmal sac, then we have to add more and more and more. And so we need to be very precise in the placement of the proximal device, sufficiently large enough so that there is absolutely no chance of embolizing that device into that distal aneurysmal sac in a very small child of 4.5 kilograms.
Yeah. I do agree with Shiva. We also have the best position for device closer, exit point or the entrance point. Or both, we may close from the exit point and entrance point, and we can close totally of the fistula. And what device you can use?
Dr. Bharat's point at the beginning itself, he was mentioning, if you are closing at the entrance point, especially in a very small baby, where the flows, once you arrest the flows, immediately there will be a rapid closure. Unlike in grown-up adults who have got a larger fistulous tracts, and the pressure that is coming out from the aortic root will be much more stronger. In a smaller baby, closing with a precisely positioned device at the entrance probably should be good.
I would agree with Shiva.
Yeah, okay, me too. And we try to close as ACC spawn. It's my view at that time. I want to use a device to close the ACC spawn, not release device soon and doing so again. And I want to see with the a device similar to the balloon test. I want to see the morphology of the fistula again and make sure that it's okay or not. And what you see, I use the device. See, the device looks extend from the entrance point to exit point already. The distal part of the device inside the RI already, and the proximal part of the device in the entrance point. And I did an angle from the guiding catheter from the aortic root.
The orientation on the lateral view of the proximal disc is not good. And so I would anticipate the moment we release the disc, this device will fall into the distal aneurysmal sac. The lateral view's position is not extremely good. One of the, I'm sure Dr. Ting, you would have done it in a supreme fashion. But one of the things that I would have chosen will be to take a uniformly cylindrical device, like an Amplatzer vascular plug 2, and start trying to position the proximal disc exactly perpendicular to the lumen, which means I go a little bit more proximal, more closer to the right coronary artery. Here we have got a lot of distance from the right coronary artery. Down, we have to understand that there is a lot of concertina of the entire fistula tract. The position of the current device in the lateral view seems to be that it is going to slip down into the aneurysm the moment it is released.
Yeah. You mean it's the device is far from the native coronary artery?
Maybe it's not like far from, but if you are choosing an Amplatzer vascular plug 2, in a little smaller size than what has been chosen now, we probably can be pushing it way up to the exact ostium of the RCA itself, and then it will get caught. Now the proximal disc is actually sitting on the narrowed tract, and the distal disc is sitting on the in the RA itself. We have actually come out the.
Yeah.
And my other concern, Tim, is that as long as you have the AV loop, the exact position of the device would be a little bit difficult to ascertain. And I won't be surprised if the device does fall back a little proximally towards the, means away from the fistula sac or away from the entry.
Yeah, you're right, Bharat. And at the time, we talk it's okay. We remove the AV loop, the wire, and you see what happened. Yeah. And when we remove the AV loop, you see still a very huge shunt. And so it seems we cross a small exit spawn, and the device just close a small exit spawn. The fistula is still very huge and vanished to the RI. And what do you think?
The lateral view seems to be the best imaging play. The X2 seems to be the precise target, and this can be achieved by putting in an Amplatzer vascular plug. Considering that your other plane projection was 5.3, I would choose an 8 mm Amplatzer vascular plug 2 and go deep inside. And on the lateral plane that you are consistently showing on the right side of the PowerPoint screen right now, position the proximal disc exactly at the place where the right coronary artery is given off. And then the one more advantage of a vascular plug is that it is far more flexible and will not the amount of memory that a vascular plug will have, and it's trying to recoil itself back into the aneurysmal sac will be
Yeah, but when I remove the AV loop wire and you see the situation like this, yeah. And should we do? We retrieve the device and cross again and do AV loop again, or we can put one more device to close from the entrance point. We keep the first device in booth one, and we wait and see to see the maybe the retention list of the device can close or what.
Tin, one of the options would be to go retrogradely with either AVP 4 8 millimeters through a diagnostic catheter, or use a micro catheter with micro coils, which could probably may be difficult to stabilize there, but you could attempt that. Those are the two options which also should be kept in mind, in my opinion, rather than only thinking about the venous access.
You see the flow is very high. I don't think the microcoil can be stable. Maybe it's very embolized. And but I try to cross the fistula again with the catheter, but you see the tortuous and the retention list of the first device. And it's not easy to cross. And you see, I try to cross by the microcatheter, but I cannot find the assist bone because you see the weight of the fistula now is very tortuous, cannot go again. And you see, if I put the micro coil over there, I think it's very easy to embolize too. And I don't think.
Tin, distally putting micro coils will not be an option. If at all you want to put them, you will have to put them much proximally in that smaller horizontal track. I think distally they will not stay, they will just embolize.
Yeah.
And the second thing is we have to resheath this particular device in order to manipulate more guide wires. Otherwise, this is a very bulky structure that is sitting within the aneurysmal sac, and it is going to prevent you from trying to access the next exit, manipulating more and more catheters. We need to resheath it again and get the device back into the sheath, and by advancing the sheath into the fistulous tract again.
Mm. But you see the device, the first device you see is across a very small hole.
Yes.
And I try to retrieve the first device, but I failed. I could not.
Oh, that is one of the very common problems. Like once you are stuck with the device, you are not able to resheath, then it becomes difficult. Your aortic catheter fortunately has gone in reasonably deeper. So Dr. Bharat's suggestion of pushing in an AVP4 at this particular point is also a good suggestion.
Yeah. Sorry, we don't have AVP4.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a problem. And we intend to put one more device, but at the entrance point. So the problem is just through the guiding catheter 5 French and what device. And we think the IDO2 may be better.
Instead of micro coils, we can probably use regular coils. And if it is safer to use irregular coils with exit points occluded by a balloon, if you can probably occlude the distal end and snare it and occlude it, then that's Dr. Bharatal just said, coils, if not micro coils, regular coils, it's pack it with it, and so that clot formation happens, and then only release it. Otherwise, it will fly. Because such a huge, tremendous torrential flow, coils are likely to fly. So, unless you can occlude the distal exit point, the bigger exit point, with a balloon occlusion or make the stasis and then deploy coils.
The problem is, Edwin, once this device is in position, to occlude anything distally is almost out of question. They don't have another access there.
You can take a wire from the arterial side, exit through the bigger exit point, snare it, and then take a balloon to the mouth of it.
That means you will have to have one more venous access.
Venous access, yeah, exactly.
Hi, Edwin. We tried to do this, but we failed. We could not cross through the SH bond again.
Oh, I see.
We used the micro catheter, we used the coronary wire, but we could not cross the small hole from the big sac, and we failed.
Oh, yeah.
And we choose the putting the way to put in the one more device entrance one, but with the 5 French guiding catheter, we tried to use the IDO2. Maybe you know the small profile. But what you see after IDO2, what happened? It's still significant residual function. And what should we do?
But that IDO2 has got embolized into the distal aneurysmal sac.
Yeah.
still that KD2 was not positioned horizontal portion that we see for the lateral view.
Yeah, you're right, Siva. And I also saw the prop situation. And when I released the device, moved to the sec. And I think maybe we need one more device. And we also want use one more device, IDU2 6x6. I want the length a little bit longer and the device go to the small part of the fissure. And you see the second IDU2. You see I advanced there. And second idea to we put inside the sac and remain inside the fissure, I think close to the native right native coronary artery.
Yeah, that's my blue job.
Yeah, and what happened with idea to it still shun a lot. And one more idea to.
You have no other choice, maybe a little more approximate.
Well, coins can be put in, which is unlikely to fly through, and bigger coins, 3, 5, 2 coils, you can back it. It might.
Because now there is enough metal in the coronaries that coils will not fly off.
But the coil, the size of the coil, and also you, what do you think if the coil moving back to some technical problems, the coil moving back to the proximal, and it's maybe it's big problem for the native coronary artery, and we need the device is maybe safer, and what we do, one more device, and the question is also the just 5 friend getting catheter, I do it again. And I think IDU2, there are no membranes inside. I changed my mind. I think we can use a small profile device, but it has
some. ABP1 or equivalent of ABP1 also is ideal because you have a tube which is straight here. The landing zone is reasonably good. Your RCA is much higher. So if you have a ABP1 equivalent, that will be good.
Yeah, IBP1, what the size? 8 or
10? I think ABP we have to oversize by 1.5 to 1.8 times ABP1. So you have to choose accordingly the diameter here so that you can squeeze ABP1 here and then put it
faster.
Or Sera vascular plug. I have significant experience of Sera vascular plug. Because it has got a 3-layered PTFE. Profile is a little bit higher with the Sera vascular plug compared to the ABP1.
But with this access, Nageshwar, vascular plug may not be very easy to get in.
Yeah, right. We need the bigger guiding catheter, 6 French.
Yeah.
And Nagesh, why don't you suggest the MFO 6-4?
Yeah, MFO 7-5 also will go through the 5 French guide catheter. Yeah, but small. I don't know what, I'm sorry, I was a bit late. I had one emergency now. So I don't know what device is it which is sitting over there.
And we decided to use the MFO.
So you have already 2 MFOs I can see there.
Yeah, all right.
Probably you have to deploy that and wait for 10 minutes and then see the shunt. If shunt is significant, then only we can think about another 7-5 MFO. You have taken 4th one, I guess.
Yeah, it's MFO 6-4. I deploy.
6-4, okay.
And what happened?
The disadvantage with 6-4, okay. There's no disadvantage. 6-4 or 7-5, both are equivalent. There's no fabric in that. That's fine.
What do you think?
Looks terrible.
Shunt, yeah, it's close.
Yeah. And after release, you see the native coronary artery looks okay. The shunt is almost be closed.
But in this particular view, what I can see is that, okay, I can see the screw is a bit away from the RCA. It looks like as if it is close to the right coronary artery origin, the retention screw of the last device, but it is a bit away.
But we changed the other angulation. Before we release, changed many angulation. We see no obstruction of the native coronary artery by screw up. And Dr. Rao, don't worry.
Okay.
And what medication after procedure? We use the heparin, aspirin, and should we use a clopidogrel or coumadin? Parath?
I don't think. I think in this case, which is a side branch fistula, aspirin alone should be okay. I don't anticipate really any thrombus propagating backwards. You have closed it reasonably proximally. So I would be happy, especially in a child with a single antiplatelet.
But the ICI, you see the ostium of ICI is very large, about 10 mm. You don't worry about the thrombosis over there?
Because of the ostium of the right coronary. My feeling is that it would remodel over a period of time. Till that time, if you want to use clopidogrel, I have no objection. But I think the flow through the native right coronary artery is so good that I don't think that it would result into thrombus formation in the proximal portion. But not a bad idea to use combination till such time there is some amount of remodeling and then go ahead with aspirin thereafter.
Nice. How about Shiva?
I got the point from Dr. Bharat that most of the proximal fistulas where there are no side branches, there is not no need to be too aggressive. However, in these sort of fistulas where there is a very small cul-de-sac right at the proximal RCA, I always will give heparin for next 48 hours, as you have written the first point, aspirin and coumadin, and continue it at least for next 6 months, coumadin in adequate doses. I'm very aggressive with the anticoagulation on fistulas which has unusual proximal sacs.
Yeah.
But we should give aspirin lifelong. That's what we are following now, because we had a very bad experience of a child who developed MI 6 years after the fistula closure. They stopped aspirin. So I do agree with both of you. I think we can give aspirin because there is no cul-de-sac. There is no significant dilated sac there. You close it completely using 4 devices.
Yeah, Queen.
Yes. Yeah, probably give only heparin. You should tend to give heparin the first 24 hours, preferably, because I mean, acute events can be avoided. And then I leave him only on aspirin, as you know, plus minus clopidogrel, such a huge aneurysm. Yeah, I probably give dual antiplatelets. I think you're giving calmarin, like, how long is the question? Like, so when you stop it again, there's again risk of coming in. So probably something is there, I'll know it earlier rather than happening it late. Yeah. There is no clear recommendation. This everybody does. Whatever thing is ideal, but then it's a tricky thing. Some once in a while you do, one patient may come back with a coronary thrombus. So you don't know which, who, and I have seen one case with long back and Chitra. One lady came back with severe RCA fistula, came back with inferior MI. She got into real trouble. But that's what here we haven't had trouble. But then better, at least in this case, dual antiplatelets would be at least for 6 months.
Yeah. But remember, this small baby, it's not easy to use coumadin for a small baby, yeah. 4.5 kilograms.
Difficult to manage, check the INR and for a small baby. So it's maybe, otherwise, you have the newer like oral anticoagulants, like newer ones can be tried, right?
And you know, Tin, if it was a distal fistula, if it was an end artery fistula, if there was a slow flow, you could give it a consideration. But if it is a proximal fistula, if it is a side branch fistula, if you have closed it adequately proximally, and if there is a brisk flow through the native artery, I don't think that I would consider coumadin in such a small child.
Yeah, okay. And so my conclusion for this case, understanding the morphology of the CAF is very important, but very difficult to understand. Sometimes we may not understand clearly the morphology before the first device, and we can see clearly after the first device, and we put the first device and we make many difficulties for crossing against and the second device, and we choose the coil for a closer assist bond or everything you suggest, because we obstruct after the first device to we cannot really switch again, and many things, many difficult things happen. And the small profile and flexible device, I think some cases are very suitable and useful for the complicated morphology of CAA. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Tinda. It's a really wonderful. I will ask Bharadali sir and Shiva to proceed with the subsequent questions to you.
My only one question to you, Tin, is that if this case were to come back to you again, would you do anything differently?
I don't think it was any different.
Would you do anything differently? Would you use a different device the first time? Would you position it somewhere else? Would you consider some different strategy, or you would go the same way again?
I think it's the same way again. Because if we put a different device, it's also in, the problem we crossed the small hole when we didn't know before. If we choose the different device, it's on the same issue. But, and I think we is maybe I can try to change my mind. I can do the balloon test to see more clearly before we put the device. Maybe, but you know, the small baby. Not easy to put the, we do the balloon test and see, because the technical issue is not easy. And I think if I change my mind, just try to do balloon test in the complicated morphology.
Would you have used a device with a fabric like a Radio 1 or something, hoping that it would produce better occlusion as compared to devices without a fabric?
Of course, the fabric member is always better for the terms of, in terms of the closing the defect. But the problem is the fabric membrane device need the big profile sheath. And for small baby, if we use the low profile device, it's always easier and better. In case this patient is the patient body weight about more than 10 or 20, we have many option to choose the devices, but it's 4.5 kg. We don't have many choices.
Understanding that we have exceeded a lot of time. One final point. This particular type of fistulas are in some parts of the world called as anterior aortic or atrial tunnel. They always have got this proximal portion of the first 1 to 1.5 centimeter narrow, and then subsequently they become aneurysmal, which invariably lies on the right side of the aorta in this anterior aortico-atrial, right atrial tunnels. And that particular area, if you target with a single ampliser vascular plug, very carefully sized in order to match the narrowest segment, that gives the best possible option. Since we have exceeded a lot of time, may I take the liberty in requesting one of the very senior person, Dr. Biswajit, to give his presentation. I thank Dr. Tin a lot. And with your background, it looks like you are relaxing, but I know that you are sitting in the hospital and you have just put it as a virtual background.
Thank you, Shiva. Thank you, Vara, Rao, Edwin also. Thank you, everybody.
Dr. Biswajit, you are unmuted now.
Yeah.
So now onwards, like, we'll have to keep the timing,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So I guess good morning to everyone. I guess this is a teaching session for all the fellows and PGTs. So I would give you a brief introduction about ductal stenting. So it can be of three types. One, from the proximal descending aorta, it usually happens in pulmonary atresia, intact IVS, critical PS, and tricuspid atresia. It is usually Krichenko type A, wide ampulla tapering down to constriction, and usually a short straight course and branch-based stenosis is probably less likely in this subset.
Biswajit, speak loudly.
Okay.
Come closer to the mic, please.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, very well.
Okay. The next subgroup is arising from the proximal middle part, that is a vertical ductus arteriosus. It usually happens in top pulmonary atresia, TGA VSD pulmonary atresia group, or complex single ventricle physiology. It arises from the underside of the arch opposite the origin of the left subclavian artery. The ductus tapers down vertically and often forms while entering into the PA. There can be a tight constriction. Next variety is intermediate origin, where it arises more proximally, long, tubular, and tortuous. Arises from the subclavian arteries, the last subset, less than 5%. Peculiar appearance, usually tight constriction at the PA end. And embryology is persistent of distal parts of the left and right sixth aortic arch. The choice of coronary wires, BMW, is rather a softer wear, and where you need more support, you can use PT Choice or Pilot 150 by Abbott or Persuader from Medtronic. Access, of course, femoral, forefringe, axillary carotid, or when you need a bilateral stenting, suppose it is a discontinued PA and need bilateral stenting for both the PAs, you can use a femoral or carotid and axillary approach. So potential complications, acute thrombosis, which is very less, 2 to 3%, but it can be life threatening. There should be a guide wire across the ductus for at least 15 minutes beyond the procedure. Small balloon, 2.5 to 3 millimeters, and you serially dilate. And then thrombolytic therapy, there is risk of bleeding, of course. And Pilot 150 Persuader can drill through the thrombus.
Biswajit, you are not clearly audible. Can you make your mic, can you hold your mic close to your mouth, please?
The mouthpiece.
Yeah. I'm doing in my laptop, actually.
Yeah. You can hold the mouthpiece closer.
Okay. Okay. Now, next is spasm of ductus arteriosus. Now, is it clear?
Yeah, it is better.
Manipulation of guide wire and placement across the ductus, and then restart PGE1 infusion. Migration of stent, usually not life-threatening, but can be serious and occurs if there is no constriction in the whole length of the ductus. That's the reason why you should stop prostaglandin before shifting the patient or the night before the procedure. And post-op care is usually ICU, ventilation for at least 12 or 24 hours. Control severe heart failure from overshunting. Follow up as per BT shunt and definite surgery. And one more very important point is unstented part of the ductus becomes stenosed rapidly, hence cover the full of the ductus. I'll show you a few examples. So this is a regular ductus from the lateral view. This is a wire to the ductus, but two wires, buddy wire technique. Okay, now this is from the left axillary, and you can see a very tortuous and this ductus, and there you have a stent across the ductus. This is a stent where you can see the ductus is quite wide open. This is from the right axillary artery, and you can see there is a strong constriction at the near the PA end. So you stent this ductus. Okay. So here also you have to use a slightly tougher wire to give you a better anchorage. And after the stenting, everything looks fine. Okay, here is a stent across covering both the sides of the ductus, that is the aortic end and the pulmonary end. And you gradually inflate. This has to be a very quick procedure, otherwise the stent will jump across to all over the place. So here is an unusual complication where due to improper anchorage of the wire, the catheter bumps into the arch and the stent becomes straight. So you can never put this into the
doctors. Okay. So you should have body wire techniques in these. And here also you can see a confluent stenosis. Very difficult to manage these. So here it's a very tortuous ductus, as you can see here. It's a very tortuous ductus and very difficult to manipulate. But once you put a tougher wire, it usually straightens out. So this is a typical example of a body wire technique. Okay, that's all. I think the time is up. And yeah, any comments?
Thanks a lot, Biswajit. It was a wonderful presentation. You actually took us through varieties of cases. Since we have exceeded the time, just one comment from Dr. Bharat.
My only question was, in that case where you showed you came from the descending aorta and the guide catheter just jumped out of the ductus, what did you do? Did you go ahead with a body wire technique or
anything? No. We took it out.
Approach?
We took it out, the whole assembly. Okay. Hello?
Yeah, we are.
Please go
ahead. So we took out the whole assembly and then did an axillary line and then put a neck stent.
Just one point that I want to convey. Dr. Biswajit, you mentioned about two types of wires. One is the Medtronic persuader wire and second is the pilot wire. Both are chronic total occlusion wires. It is my strong recommendation to the youngsters among this group that don't take any CTO wires which is having a higher wire tip through a ductus arteriosus of a newborn which is full of mesangial tissues. They can dissect badly. And so it will always be a very floppy wire.
Correct, Shiva. But in where you are using a body wire technique, and suppose the only the BMW wire is not giving enough support, or in case where you have thrombosed the ductus, then it is better to use carefully these wires and get rid of the situation.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm not seeing who is the presenter, but already I'm seeing an 8-day-old baby.
Kannan is presenting, Shiva. Kannan is presenting.
Kannan, please go ahead. Thank you, Kannan. Kannan from Vadamalayan Hospital, Madurai, is another very versatile cardiologist. Kannan, over to you.
Yeah. Your
Kannan, proceed.
Yeah, okay. Are you able to hear me? Yeah. Okay. So this is case one. 8-day-old child evaluated for murmur plus mild tachypnea. Found to have bicuspid aortic valve with severe aortic stenosis, pressure gradient in more than 100 millimeters of mercury, and planned for balloon aortic valvulotomy. And this is a regular angiogram. Surprisingly, arterial puncture was okay, but subsequently the problem started, and LV entry with various wire combinations was unsuccessful. So we tried all the possible things, and during this process, repeatedly our wire was going to left coronary artery, and we were really worried. So we decided to go with antegrade technique. But when the day is bad, you cannot get into the venous, femoral venous, both sides we failed actually. So whenever we fail to get a venous puncture, our routine has been non-routine, meaning the need is less. But what we do is we generally do some IJV puncture or axillary venous puncture and pass the wire through the IVC into the femoral vein, have that as a marker and get the femoral venous puncture. Still, we are not very comfortable with ultrasound-based arterial accesses, which I have to learn, I think. But that was there in the mind. But before that, I thought, why can't we attempt through the umbilical venous route? Because this child was some 8-year-old child. So as you can see, when you pass a wire through the umbilical vein, can you want this area where the umbilical vein joins the left hepatic vein through this ductus venous? At that point, there will be usually a kind of tortuous course. Many times our wire will get stuck there if the ductus venous is already closed. But here I am passing a 0.4 wire which has crossed that area. And subsequently, I took a JR catheter to see whether the track is fine enough to take the balloon. And when I injected from the JR catheter, I saw that actually the LV and the aorta were functioning. That means the catheter was already into the LA. So we had a very good wire position, very smooth wire position. But however, taking the balloon posed some difficulty. As you can see, it was getting stuck at the mitral valve repeatedly. It was not crossing the mitral valve. It was a 630 millimeter tight stack mini balloon. But anyway, we took the balloon and we quickly dilated. And as you can see, as I was forcing the balloon, it took a very awkward loop and my wire was almost lost. But anyway, because the balloon was across, I quickly dilated. And during this process, what was coming to my mind was, because there was some resistance at mitral valve level and my catheter was not going through that balloon catheter. So I thought of taking a long sheath up to the right atrium and then redoing the procedure. But luckily I could get the balloon across and dilate. And I redirected to ensure that there was no residual stenosis there. So this is a post angiogram. And as you can see, mild aortic regurgitation, which very many times we see here. Child had a very much reduced gradient and uneventful recovery subsequently. So this was my first experience with doing a balloon dilatation through trans umbilical vein. So I thought I'll share that. Second one is a bit more, slightly more interesting, I can say, because a 4-day-old child, four-year-old child, PDI device closure was done elsewhere 4 months back. There was a persistent continuous murmur. Echo in our hospital showed a device in usual position by echo. There was a large residual flow. The width was measuring around 4 millimeters. The pressure gradient of 72/30, and the LA and LV were dilated. And this is the angiogram. As you can see, the device has slipped into the roof of the main pulmonary artery, but still it was stable, but probably endothelialized, and there was a significant residual flow. And now it is something like a tunnel-like PDA, and ADO is not a good choice, and probably vascular plug is a better choice. But I chose to do coil procedure because we had done this quite large numbers, like Shiva, Edwin, others will know. So I'm taking the 7-French balloon sheath across. There was a mild resistance at the LV entry, but I could enter. And as you can see, you watch the catheter, the coils will come. See, there are three coils here. 0.05266 coil 2 and 0.338355 coil 1. And that was held by the 5.2 biaptome. And this is how we prepare the coils for those who haven't seen many of the juniors would not have seen such procedures. The coils are protruded out. The tip of the coils have a small ball. That ball-like area is further pulled out and we tie them using a silk or some other non-absorbable material. And it will look like this. They all will be joined together by this one single tip. And that will be held with the 5.2 biaptome. And when you pull the biaptome through the sheath, usual femoral vena sheath, the coil will unwind and come as a long structure into the sheath. And subsequently, we depart. As you can see here, only slight push is given to the coil. Mostly, we are pulling back the sheath. When you pull back the sheath, the coils get coils by itself and it occupies the ductal ampulla. Once the stable position is achieved, I am pulling back one and a half coils into the main pulmonary artery and I am releasing. How do I know that the coils have come into the ampulla and the stabilization has occurred? The coils which are moving along with the aortic flow will suddenly stop the movement and it will become more compacted. And this is the final angiogram. So there was no flow in the echo on the next side and the child went home well. Okay, so that's all from me. Thank you very much.
Two good presentations, Kannan. One question from one of the participants. How did you ensure that your O14 coronary wire that you are passing through the PFO is not trapping some part of that newborn's mitral valve?
See, it's difficult. It's only a trial and error only. Number one, I got a very smooth curve. That means it's not practically trapped in only one particular area. Second thing, when I showed the balloon was having some difficulty. I was not forcing it very forcefully. As I told, rather at one point of time, I thought I'll remove the entire thing and redo it. We cannot ensure by any way beforehand. We have to just do it and see that our catheter passes it very smoothly. When I was about to remove the wire and redo it, the balloon just passed across it and they quickly dilated.
The second question that is from one of the participants is that this is an extremely unstable device on the second case, which is just hanging in the roof of the left pulmonary artery. And what sort of backup options that you have in case when you are manipulating the main ductus, the device slips out? Because this is a 4-month-old device, which right. Now got very rigid, and it is going to, if you have to snare it out, it will need something like a 11-French sheath because it's not going to be flexing into a,
exactly.
It will become very harder.
See, it would have been very, very difficult. One thing is that if you see the device position, it is not a kind of partially dislodged. It was almost dislodged and hanging at the roof of the main pulmonary, but it was
remaining. So what sort of precaution that you had taken? Like the viewers will be interested to know what is your backup?
No, see, actually, I didn't think that it will embolize, because unless it is endothelialized, it will not be hanging up. That's what my opinion was. Had that been in the PDA itself and having some residual flow above and below and slightly moving with the aortic flow, I would have been worried that probably it is going to embolize. But here it is hanging at the roof, but very stable. It was not even moving with the heart. So I was very sure that it was endothelialized, and hence I just simply went ahead. I did not think that it will embolize.
Thanks. That was a wonderful case. The question about the another question that has come up is, what is the LPA occlusion by the ADO? I am sure that device was not occluding the LPA.
Yes, it was in the roof, and the LPA was.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Kannan. Can we move on to the next question?
Yeah, Dr. Bawa, you can connect.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks to the organizer for giving me opportunity to present my experience on feasibility of transcatheter closure of guard body defect, that is congenital LV2RA shunt. If it is feasible, then what is the suitable device for it? Before going to the main topic, I would like to take a couple of seconds time to describe what is guard body defects. The guard body defects is divided into three categories. First one is the direct guard body defects, when the LV2RA shunt is above the tricuspid valve. And next one is the indirect guard body defect, when the defect is below the tricuspid valve. And another thing, that is the intermediate guard body defect, which is quite rare, when there is two jet, one is above the tricuspid valve and another was is below the tricuspid valve. We have done two intermediate and one direct guard body defect closure by single device. My first case, that was 8 years old girl, which was clinically suspected like that of VSD, but echo and ECG shows, along with the features of VSD, there was significant RA dilatation. Then we have done echocardiography that revealed that it was not a case of simple VSD, it was intermediate guard body defect. That is, one jet is above the tricuspid valve and another jet is below the tricuspid valve. By this echocardiography, we can appreciate the normal VSD type of thing, that is the below the tricuspid valve, there is a jet which is indirectly going to the RA. But in this view, that is the angiography, is clearly shown that there is two jets, one is below the tricuspid valve and another jet is at LV2RA, which is directly filling the RA. We have tried to close it in the cath lab. What we have done the angiography like that of other VSDs. We have taken 60-20, 30-30 view, along with we have taken 145-45, that is hepatoclavicular view. And it turned out to be around about 9 to 10 millimeter in size. Then we have crossed the crosser defect like that of VSD only. Only exception, that is the catheter course was different. That is from the aorta to LV to R to IVC. From IVC, we snared and we made one AV loop. Then we have taken 1-7 French Amplaza PGA delivery system, and the device was 12 by 10 AGO1. You can appreciate that there was lots of hesitation on my hand movement, because the defect was so much posterior that I was quite apprehensive that this total delivery system may jump from aorta to RA directly. After little bit difficulties, I was able to put it in a perfect position, and we have done the pictal angio, and you can see there is huge infra device residual, although the device has already closed two defect by one device. This is the echocardiography where you can appreciate there is huge amount of intra device residual, and one disc is towards the RA and another disc is towards the LV. Our hypothesis is that this is not closed by the waist of the device. This is closed, these two defect is closed by the retention skirt of the device. So there was almost no rhythm abnormality, which may be there, but we have faced lots of problem with macroscopic hematuria, which we address by supportive care. Now my second case, that is the 5 years old 11 kg patient, which was also suspected like that of VSD, but after doing echo we have confirmed is a case of LV2 adhesion. It was direct in leg. You can see the still images where the direct jet is coming from LV2 RA. The measurement was around 5 millimeter. What we have done here, we have done same thing like that of crossing like that of VSD from aorta to LV, but the catheter course here is also different from aorta to LV to RA to SVC. Then we put 1/5 ADO2 device like that of VSD closer. Only difference is that the one disc is towards the RA and another disc is towards the LV. Here we were a little bit apprehensive about the microscopic hematuria or macroscopic hematuria because there was no cloth, but surprisingly that patient behaved very good. There was no hematuria and no rhythm disturbances, so we discharged that patient at the day of life. Now my third case, that is the 11th month old 8 kg baby, which was referred like that of VSD, but after doing echocardiography, we confirmed that this is a case of intermediate type of guard body defect, that is one jet from below the tricuspid valve and another jet from the above the tricuspid valve. Then this is the still picture where we can appreciate this is quite a large defect and which measures about 9 to 10 millimeter. Then we have done angiography in different views, 30 as well as 60-20 as well as 45-45 views. Then we in this case we have able to cross it from the right side in AP view. What we are doing nowadays, we are crossing in AP view with a JR catheter as well as wire technique. My colleague, that is Dr. Devasree, is holding the catheter and I am manipulating the wire. And we are also using intra-procedure echocardiography to see the catheter position. Here we can appreciate the catheter, that the sheath position is like that of totally different. That is the sheath, that is a Moulin sheath, it's coming from RA to LV directly. Then we have taken 10x8 MFO device and trying to it in proper way so that one disc can be in the LV side, another one in the RA side. We have done angio, which is showing there is huge intra device residual. This is a procedure I have already mentioned. I would like to show the echo views. Here we can see a large part of the device is inside the RA. And this is the post-device deployment echocardiography. Here, I would like to mention that we have confirmed that the STL as well as APL is not inside the device. So post-procedure, it was also not very difficult or critical. This is my summary. And I would like to take a couple of minutes time here because technically it's not very much challenging one. Anyone who can do VSD device closer can do this procedure, but it needs huge judgment because we are very close to the conduction system. So at the time of choosing device, we should take it in mind that we should not oversize the device as well as try to take as much as possible low profile device and preferably single disc device. And next one is the tricuspid valve. Yeah, it's very important to assess the tricuspid valve on table by 2D echocardiography because if we put color, there are chances that we may misinterpret. There is lots of LV2 aeration, direct, indirect, as well as cable-induced tricuspid valve regurgitation. So it is better or absolutely necessary to confirm that no portion or no part of the tricuspid valve is entangled inside the device. And about the volume of the TR, it's very difficult and we cannot expect that 100% reduction of the tricuspid regurgitation on table because it's a high flow situation and it's an obligatory shunt. So it will take some time. Don't take the drastic decision about the taking out the device. It might take lots of time. And the hematuria, the same principles is applicable in case of hematuria. We have managed it by conservative management only. So about the ideal device, there is no ideal device for that, but we have to consider about a soft, low profile, easily trackable device with single disks. If possible, that if it is a conical one, then we can take ADO1, although ADO1 is a high profile device. If it is a very small type of thing like that of our second case, we can take low profile device like that of ADO2, which is very much self-centered as well as easily trackable. If it is more than 5 millimeter, then we as well as it is a tunnel shaped, then we have only two options, that is the muscular device and the MFO. In between muscular device, the I think MFO is better because it is low to medium profile as well as a little bit small. Thank you everyone. I think now the expert can comment.
Thank you. It was good to hear you, Dr. Mahua. And there are many questions. People were repeatedly asking, why do you want a disc on the right atrial side? Because the pressure gradient from left ventricle to right atrium is enormous, that a single disc defect device may suffice. But you have proven your point that you are using softer, low profile devices. The second question was about conduction tissue, and again you have addressed it. Thanks a lot. It was wonderful. In the view of, since time is low, Dr. Bharat, any specific comments?
No, my only comment is that I don't have that much of courage to do these VSDs, especially in flow, because of various issues that were alluded to, tricuspid valve conduction, so on and so forth. But they have documented very well, I think. Great show.
Dr. Devaprasad, you can share the screen.
Dr. Devaprasad from Coimbatore is another very young, dynamic person. Go ahead,
Devaprasad. I'm not able to share the screen.
There is a button below the next share screen.
On the bottom.
Satya, make your next person ready.
Yes.
Are you able to see?
Yes. Maybe yes, 1 year male.
Very good morning to everyone. I'll make it a short and sweet presentation. This is a 1-year-old male child who came to me with a recurrent respiratory infection. He was admitted for 2 times for acute episodes of lower respiratory tract infection and respiratory distress. Not able to move the slide.
Use the arrow mark, sir. Up and down. Yes, sir.
This was the chest x-ray of the child. It was unremarkable except for the prominent portion of the IV, SVC. And echo was showing a moderate sized ASD. It was 8 millimeter. And except for the prominent and little mildly dilated SVC, I could not find any abnormalities in this echo. So I gave a reassurance to the parents, diet advice, and they didn't start any antifilarial medication. But again, within a few weeks, the child again got admitted with third episode of LRTA, and he came back to me for a second opinion. So other than this dilated SVC, I was thinking that this child will have a, did I miss any PAPVC or something? So as a routine, we asked for a routine blood investigation, which are all normal. And in our department, we planned to do a CT cardiac. So this was the still pictures. Because of want of time, I not put much images. I will come to it later. The diagnosis is an abnormal venous communication was there from the IVC to the portal venous system. This is Abernethy malformation. So we took the child to the cath lab to see for the hemodynamics. The right femoral vein was cannulated, and you can see the injection. The right femoral vein is draining. It's connected to the IVC. The part of the IVC is not missing, and it is azygos continuation. It's draining into the SVC. The second catheter is put into the fistulous communication, where you can see the fistulous communication is draining into the portal vein, which is branching the right and left portal vein, and with good peripheral arborization. So this is the fistulous communication between the IVC and the main portal vein, and the intrahepatic portion of the IV is also visible, but it was a little smaller in size. So balloon interrogation, the complete occlusion of the fistulous communication, and then we measure the pressure into the portal vein. And coming to this CT scan again, this was the abnormal venous connection between the IVC and portal vein. And this is the azygos, and this is the aorta, and this is the abdominal fistulous communication. Surprisingly, the IVC was not interrupted, and the intrahepatic IVC was what I felt it was underfilled, so it is looking small, but it was normal for this age. So coming to the portal pressure, the before the balloon occlusion, the portal pressure was 10 millimeter of mercury. Post balloon occlusion was 16. The fistula was measuring 10 millimeter, and the length of the fistula from the IVC to the portal vein is 10 millimeter. So the diagnosis is a congenital extrahepatic portal systemic shunt type 2, subarachnoid malformation type 2. And child also had a moderate ostium secondum ASD. What was rare, what I could feel, was there was a venous malformation. There's azygos diversion of the IVC blood into the SVC, and a small intrahepatic portion of the IVC was present. There was no PAH and there was portal hypertension. So this is a type 2 abnormal malformation, which is amenable to surgical as well as interventional procedure. Type 1, the only treatment is for surgery. So these were the options we had, and we had a discussion with our liver team in our Sri Ramakrishna Hospital, an intervention radiologist and parents, and we mobilized the funds for this procedure. And what we decided is to do close this fistula with the amplaster vascular plug 2. So the hardware, what I used was 8 French Moulin sheath and 14 millimeter amplaster vascular plug. This is a vascular catheter from the left femoral vein, which is parked into the mesenteric vein. This is a mesenteric vein, which is draining into the main portal vein. And through the other right femoral vein, 8 French sheath is passed and parked into the fistula. And this is the sheath injection showing the fistulous communication, which is draining into the main portal vein. And the right and left portal vein are present and with good peripheral arbolization. And this is the azygos continuation, which is draining into the SVC, and this is a small intrahepatic portion of the IVC. The difficulties what we had is before deploying is the amplaster vascular flood should sit into the fistula so that it should not obstruct the portal vein as well as the IVC, which is intrahepatic portion of the IVC, and also it should not obstruct the azygos. So we deployed the 14 millimeter amplaster vascular plug into the fistula. So the last portion of the device, we actually pushed the cable so that it just got packed inside the fistula. So post deployment, if we see the injection into the superior mesenteric vein, which showed unobstructed flow into the main portal vein, and sheath injection showed the good opacification of the intrahepatic portion of the IVC as well as the azygos. So this is the final injection where the device got literally packed inside the fistulous communication, and there was no obstruction to either the IVC or the portal vein. So after this procedure, the child was on aspirin for 6 months, and low molecular weight heparin for 3 to 4 weeks, and portal venous Doppler surveillance and clinical examination. She is followed for past 1 year and is asymptomatic till now. What rare about this procedure is the abnormal venous communication what I found. Secondly, this child didn't come to us with symptoms of any liver dysfunction or pulmonary hypertension or low cyanosis. He came with a recurrent respiratory infection. Incidentally, we found out this fistulous communication, and we closed it successfully. And thank you.
Good case, Deva. You have shown to others that anybody who is having some form of IVC anomaly is likely to have another venous anomaly. There is a much higher incidence of abnormality in patients with IVC interruption. But what perplexes me is, what will be the necessity to do this intervention in a one-year-old child who probably does not have any features that was caused, that was created by any problem created by this abnormality malformation? Could this procedure be have been delayed by a few more years, wait for ammonia to shoot up, wait for some sequelae? I'm sure you have handled it very nicely, but that was one of the questions.
Definitely, we had this issue, sir. What we discussed with the liver transplant surgeon is we can wait till the symptoms started. But the liver transplant surgeon opined that post balloon occlusion, the portal pressure increased to 16. And he was telling that if you leave this fistula again, because azygos, all the blood is diverting into the azygos, the portal veins will get underfilled and they will not be in a good size in the future. So that's what he opened, that you close the fistula as soon as possible.
What happens to the natural history in terms of portal hypertension once you close this decompressing channel?
With our discussion with the liver team and our pediatric cardiologist, and this is a pediatrician, natural course, it will, portal venous pressure will decrease because the most of the blood will go into the portal vein, and both the right and the left portal vein are in good size and the liver function is normal. If at all, if there is a position that the portal pressure increases, our liver surgeon was planning to do a splenorenal shunt in the future to decrease the portal hypertension in the future. He's in close follow-up with our team.
Any medications that you will give when the portal pressure increases? Maybe Dr. Nageshwar can tell.
But he's not here.
So there was a question about whether propranolol will be started if there is a... Since you have increased the portal venous pressure from 10 to 16. Deva, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes, sir. So, we didn't start on any medication. He was on continuous Doppler surveillance of the and LFT. He was asymptomatic, and Doppler surveillance as well as the LFT was normal. So we didn't do anything.
My just one suggestion will be, in a child who is not having a symptom that is attributable to Abernethy malformation, it may be a good idea to just wait for some more time for the venous structures to become very decently developed, and then go ahead, because this patient had a good landing zone. So we can always close it at any point of time. A child of just 1 year weighing 8 kilograms is quite a small for us to understand a lot of portal hemodynamics. Obviously, your discussions with the liver transplant surgeon would have helped you. Thanks a lot, Deva. That was a wonderful presentation.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Sir, next is Dr. Shahad from Aligarh AMU. Dr. Kamran. Yeah.
Dr. Kamran, yeah.
Very good morning to everyone. So I will be sharing you a very interesting story.
Kamran, Akbari, all in one common name?
No, sir. They both are sharing the same system.
Okay, I know Kamran well, but okay, thank you.
So it's a story of a teenage girl, a 17-year-old female, who was a student of class 12, a school level swimmer. And the important part is that she belongs to a doctor family. Her father was a homeopathic doctor in our city, and she turned with an echo report. The echo report which is saying that the child was having a ASD. And the important part was the father asked me that you people are doing device closures in your center. I only want a device closure in this girl. So we did an echo, and which revealed a large ASD around maximum RAM 24 mm with floppy IVC ring.
You're unable to see your screen.
Okay.
Satya, is it?
Sir, you can share the screen once again, sir. Okay. Stomach is dark.
Just a moment.
One second. I will stop your sharing for a minute, for a second, and then you can start now. I'll stop it now.
Can I start now?
You can show now.
Okay. Is it coming now?
No, sir. It's coming as black. PowerPoint is on.
The PowerPoint is on. My PowerPoint is on.
You paint the PowerPoint? Like the play the slideshow?
Just a minute.
It's on slideshow? Correct. Shall we move to the next one and then come back? So next we have Dr. Bhushan, if you're ready.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Kamran sir, we'll come back.
Okay, okay.
Good morning, sir. Hello.
We are seeing your slides very clearly.
Good morning, sir, respected seniors. This is a very difficult case that we had faced. It's a large right coronary sinus to RA fistula, and we had a nightmare during that case. This was a 27-year-old lady who had presented with dyspnea, which had progressively worsened from class 2 to class 3 in the last 6 months. She had no history of chest pain or pedal edema. Her past history was unremarkable. On examination, she had signs of cardiac failure. RV type of cardiomegaly was present. Her S1 was normal with S2, which revealed a normal split with a normal second heart and a loud continuous murmur in an unusual location in the left parasternal, more towards the right upper parasternal area. Echo showed only dilated right atrium, right ventricle with a huge right coronary sinus, and we suspected probably a large coronary fistula would be present. So we did a CT angio for this patient, and it demonstrated a humongous right coronary sinus to RA fistula, measuring 23 mm in its largest dimension and 7 mm at its smallest dimension with a single exit more posteriorly. And we also like to call it as a large aorta to RA tunnel. So this is how it looked on a CT angiogram in different views. We can see the dilated coronary sinus and the right coronary arising separately. On CAT table, we had taken an artery and a venous puncture line. Plan was to go make an arteriovenous loop and go from the venous side. So first, to demonstrate the coronaries, we had done the coronary angiogram. This was followed by delineation of the fistula. So various views based on the CT and AP and a lateral were marginally able to show the fistula very well. Being a very torrential flow, it was very difficult to evaluate the fistula. So what we did was, using a exchange lens thermo wire, we crossed the fistula, snared the wire and made an AV loop and did a balloon interrogation. But the trouble started there. We were not able to enter the exit of the fistula. The balloon somehow only just tried to negotiate to some extent. But then we used this as a balloon occlusion test to delineate the fistula, and we had to take to the plan B. So we were not able to enter from the venous end. So probably we had to close the fistula from the arterial end. So looking at the narrowest part of the fistula, which was more proximal, so we decided to use MFO 10 by 12 and close that narrow length of the fistula. So another arterial puncture was taken, and we used a 7-French sheath, and through which a 10 by 12 MFO was loaded and positioned across the narrowest end. Throughout, angiography was done to ascertain the position. While positioning the fistula, the device into the fistula, there was a deformation of the first disc, and we thought so that we are in a good position after confirmation of 10 minutes of angiogram. But immediately as we released, this is what it happened. The device embolized just at the exit, and we were all stunned. So didn't know what to do next. So we had a very important plan, probably either to retrieve the device or consider a surgical correction for this patient. But suddenly I thought, why not do one simple angio? And what I wanted had already happened. The device was sitting very well into the exit. There was no chance of device embolization beyond that point. So why not go with another device, upsize the device and try to close that narrow part. As it measured 7 mm, 10-12 was just snugly fitting. So we considered the largest size, which is 12-14, again MFO, and try to close this end. So this time we use a regular wire and use the PDA sheath, which was again a 7-French sheath. Because of the curve, we could easily go ahead beyond that narrow portion. Making the device load was very smooth. Now comes the tricky portion again. During deployment, I had to use plenty of tension and to get that device into the position. And this is what happened after deployment We waited for 10 minutes. At least we could visualize that the flow had reduced. The device deformation was good enough and it looked very stable, though I was a little scared. And also in different orthogonal views, had to confirm that the coronary is normal. The right coronary was not having an issue. So a pre-deployment angiograms in different views. And the flow had reduced nearly about 90%. Waited for at least minimum 10-15 minutes before I could go ahead with deployment. And the moment of truth, as we deployed, there was not even an inch in the movement of the device. And we heaved a sigh of relief. The check angiogram after release showed that device sitting well in position with a normal flow across the coronary. And this was the last before we removed the catheters out. So it was a true unconventional procedure. The age of presentation, the device used, though the MFO1 had embolized to the exit of the fistula, used a second MFO deferring surgery. Learning points, good angiographic delineation necessary for torrential fistulas. Balloon occlusion test plays a very important role. MFO, a very novel device, considering the low profile, easy trackability, can be screwed from both the sides. The presence of a Dacron patch in the larger devices, more than 9 mm, helps in endothelialization. And don't hesitate to send for surgery if everything fails. This is how the device was sitting after stretch position. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhushan. That was wonderful. Actually, it was almost exactly similar to Dr. Tin's case. The only thing, the difference was in the age of the patient. Otherwise, it was exactly a replay of the same sort of anatomy, same sort of strategy, same sort of problems. And one question that came up in the chat box, probably to both Dr. Tin and Bhushan, again, people are asking, would a straight cylindrical device like an ADP2 be a better choice than shaped device?
Yes, sir. AVP2 would have been a definite choice. But here, in case of MFO, the retention disc which is there probably gives you more advantage and the strength to deploy. There is no deformation in AVP2. It stays in its own structure. So we have to pack it inside the... So probably I feel, personal opinion, MFO is a little better than AVP2 in this kind of situation.
Dr. Barak?
My question is that you say that it's a torrential fistula. What was the problem in getting the sheath across the venous side of the fistula?
The opening was in a very weird position, sir, very close to the valve. So we were not able to negotiate through that point, getting into from the venous side.
Did you attempt with a sheath at all or only with a balloon?
Even a simple guide catheter could not go. As a result of which, I tried to put a balloon and try to occlude. So that didn't happen. So I didn't go ahead with the sheath. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Kamran is still not ready, so we can go with Dr. Nitro Mukherjee.
Yeah. I can start?
Yes.
Please.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Before I start, I'm presently working at Medica Hospital, Kolkata, but this case is from my previous institute, Narayana Hospital, where I spent a fair bit of a time. So, this is a slightly different take on a nightmare case. Normally, in nightmares, we show something which has gone wrong in the lab and we take an effort to correct it. This was definitely a nightmare, but a slightly different take. So this was the 8-month-old male who came to our ER in quite dilapidated conditions, had very low. This was one of our follow-up cases, actually. Had undergone bilateral Glenn for single ventricle pulmonary atresia. The child had some borderline branch PS, but it was more than 6 months, and we preferred to do a Glenn instead of a shunt in this patient. Intra-op, there were a few challenges with regards to the branch PS sizes, but the surgeons could do a decent job. Post-operatively, the SATs were a little borderline. There were some flow turbulence across the Glenn, but since this was a difficult surgery, we wanted to keep a close watch and discharge on aspirin. Unfortunately, they stopped aspirin and they landed up in our ER in that condition. So we immediately intubated, ventilated. There was significant bilateral effusion for which drains were inserted. On echo, there was no flow in either BDG on admission of this child. And we could not see the flow even after removal of the fluid from the lungs. So the question was whether we will go for an emergency rescue surgery, we'll do a CT scan or some sort of other imaging. So by this time, while we were contemplating this, the child had two back-to-back CPRs and time was running out. So we felt that we had to do something to this, at least demonstrate what is happening. So we shifted urgently to the lab and we took in two peripheral lines and we bilateral venograms, and it showed what you were actually dealing with. So basically, as you can see in the right venogram, there is no complete non-visualization of the RIJV, RSVC, everything was draining through the azygos into the IVC. The left gland injection showed retrograde flow into the LIJV, and there was a huge homogeneous thrombus in the lower part of the LIJV. So both the glands are blocked, and now we can understand why this child is in such a bad shape. While we were doing this, the child required another CPR. And we felt probably the right side was a more of a chronic obstruction. Maybe the left side had, based on the thrombus, and it was appearing slightly mobile. Also, we felt maybe it's more of an acute. If we can somehow establish the flow in the left BDG, maybe we'll be able to save this child. So luckily, we got a quick access and we put in a sheath. And the sheath angiogram was even more, it showed, I'll play it again. Yeah, as we can see that the thrombus in the lower part of the LIJV is extending into the upper part of the LSVC. There is also a huge thrombus occupying the entire part of the LPA. There is significant narrowing at the left glen and left BDG anastomotic site, and also the RPA look diminutive. So we are dealing with a Pandora's box here. So first things first, we immediately started anticoagulation, and we gave heparin 100 units and another 50 units we gave through the sheath. We wanted to thrombolize, we wanted to give an RTPA. Tenecteplase can be given as a bolus in these scenarios, but we did not have pediatric experience. We did not also have it in the lab. We had some experience with Ultiplase, so we started it at a high dose of 0.3 mg per kg per hour through the systemic route. So after the few, maybe 10-15 minutes after the initial efforts, once we have started the thrombolysis and given heparin, there was some marginal improvement in saturation, but we realized unless we do something to the anastomotic site, the stasis won't improve and we won't be able to make much headway. So we took a low pressure Tyshak balloon. We did not want to use any high pressure balloons considering it was only around a month from the surgery. We dilated the left gland site, and as we can see, some improved flow has now started to happen. What to do about the right side? There was no way with the amount of thrombolytics that was going on, we would even under ultrasound guidance, we would try to prick from above. So we tried to poke from below blindly whether we can recanalize the thing, but it was of no avail. But something needed to be done to the right side because we had a very narrow confluence, and then the RP also looked cicatrized, maybe from the right gland anastomotic stricture. And unless we dilate the entire system, some portion of the clot might occlude the entire portion of the RPA after getting lyse. So we, 2-3 times we dilated the entire, from the confluence to the right hilum with another Tyshak balloon. And this was the initial result. With, now we can see some improved flow to both the lungs. Obviously the PAs look a little bit over dilated, but we are not that worried at this point because the PAs are quite distendable structures. And the hemodynamics improved by this point. Saturation SAS went up to 70%. However, we started to have a different problem due to the high dose of RTPA. We started to have profuse bleeding. So we stopped the systemic Ultiplase. We shifted it to the left interjugular vein and started at a lower dose of 0.1 mg per kg per hour. And we shifted that night, we felt that we could not do anything more in the lab. We shifted to the pediatric ICU for overnight ventilation. And this is the, after 10 hours, we took the child back. So obviously overnight, the numbers have improved. The hemodynamics have settled. Urine output has started to form. And as we can see from the final angio that the entire gland system have opened up and there is decent enough pulmonary blood flow to both the lungs with good pulmonary venous return. So much so that the child could be extubated after 4 hours, drains removed the next day, heparin, we continued for 48 hours, overlapped with warfarin, and we discharged after 4 days. So on follow-up, the child is doing fairly well. Thankfully for all of us, there is no neurological issues in spite of having survived 3-4 attempts of CPR. We stopped the warf after 6 months. We continued aspirin. As of now, the child is nearly 1 year post follow-up. Fats are around 80%, obviously, because we have not attended to the right side, and probably it is still draining to collaterals, maybe to the IVC. So it's effectively right to lesion, but we are happy that the child is alive and doing well. And we have planned for an early Fontan completion. So discussion, I don't think much is needed. It's very obvious in this patient for this audience. What I would like to say, whether this situation was avoidable, whether we could have gone for a shunt in place of that is something a little bit of a questionable. We are discussing in our CAP conference. We normally tend to go beyond 6 months. In borderline cases also, we have done quite a few Glens instead of shunts because we try to avoid ductal stent repetition beyond 6 months in a single ventricle scenario. Postoperative, whether we could have done something to this child, yes, probably yes, maybe. But once again, it's hindsight is always good. So such a salvage would not have been possible without the wonderful team we had there, headed by Dr. Amitabh, and also I would like to acknowledge the role of Dr. Sanjeevan and all the other team members. So the best thing about any nightmare is that it always ends. Thankfully, this child, it ended well for us.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Aritra. It was a wonderful presentation. We saw your publication in Cardiology in the Young as well. The one surprise to me was that in many of these patients, the distal runoff is poor, which leads to thrombus formation. Just simple balloon dilatations of the anastomotic area and of the confluence to stay open for long periods of time and maintain antegrade Glenn flows for a longer period is a little surprising. In some of the patients, it might again collapse back. But it was a very good thing that your patient stayed comfortable for the next 6 more months. Dr. Bharat?
I wanted to make only two quick comments. One is whether it is a venous shunt or an arterial shunt which is thrombosed. When you mechanically disrupt this thrombus, most of the thrombi go distally, and that is why having an anticoagulation or a fibrinolytic on board is an excellent strategy. And this is not uncommon that immediate post-recanalization angiograms look very shabby, but after 6 to 8 hours, the angiograms look extremely well. That was one comment. And the second comment I wanted to make is that at least whatever little bit I had seen in my earlier days of practice is that once a shunt gets thrombosed, whether it is venous or arterial, the propensity of that child to get re-thrombosis is very high. And we would not wait just recanalizing and letting things go on for days on or months on. We would like to fix the problem or do a more definitive surgery as soon as possible. So these were my two comments.
True. I think definitive solutions in univentricular facts are even more challenging in a very small 8-month-old child. So I think this is a very difficult scenario, very easily managed.
In this case, I would not consider a more definitive procedure because the child is very young. But if it were to be something else, like for example, tetralogy with a BT shunt, 8-month-old child, I would consider recanalization and try and repair this child as soon as possible.
For this case, sir, what we felt was on follow-up when the child was doing well, we had kept a backup plan that whether we will go back to some other, whether we'll put in an additional BT shunt in this case, even a small shunt we had thought. But since the child was doing very well, the Glenn was flowing well, we had no other options other than putting a BT shunt.
I take your point on this case perfectly. Yes. I mean, you have done it. You have done a great job, and it's a great save.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We welcome now Dr. Kamran back. Kamran from Aligarh.
Sir, you can go ahead.
So, am I audible?
Yes.
Now you are audible.
Okay. Sorry about that case only. So, it's a very interesting. History of belongs to a doctor family, and they were well informed. She came in her hand and she told me that she is having an ASD, but the issue we have read some in the newspaper that we are doing some device closure, so that's the reason for coming to us. So we have done the echo, and what we saw that there is large OS ASD with a maximum diameter of 24 mm with floppy IVC ring. And rare stems were adequate. There was no feature of PAH and RAR was dilated. So we have, after counseling that we told that device is possible, but it's not, we can't guarantee that it's 100% chance that we could be able to do a device only. So after proper counseling, we took that girl into the cath lab. The plan was to do HD device closure with 26 mm plus a septal occluder under a transthoracic echo, because the views are quite kind of very nice views were there. We were taken into the cath lab, no arterial line were taken, the study was done, and in a routine way we have planned this case. And we were lucky enough that we have done this case in our first attempt through the LUPV technique. So after putting the device was sitting very nicely. We have confirmed it in echo also. We've decided to relieve the device. And eventually the device was relieved. And after that, device was stayed in position. And we thought that all is well. We kept our promise. The child will not be having any scar now. And we were thinking that all is well. But within 10 minutes, what we realized that it's actually not all is well. Everything wasn't well. So all in well. What happened and what are the reason of the all in well? The reason was this. Within 10 minutes it happened. So the child was in the cath lab only at that time. So the problem was that the device was freely movable, moving to and fro from RA to RE. It was very difficult to hold the device. We have lots of time we have wasted in fishing that with this snare, and I will not waste that time to showing that to fill attempt. Finally, we changed the strategy. First, we have tried to make the device more stable. So we have taken another femoral puncture on the left side. And after that, we have taken a 018 wire, just tried to cross the device through the right side. After crossing, we have confirmed that it is through the device in the lateral position also. And once we have showed that wire has crossed the device, from the left femoral vein, we have taken an MP with an snare. And we have snared this cross wire, which we have already placed in the RPA through the device. And after snaring it, we have took out the snared part from the left femoral vein. So it helped us in a way that it makes this device very stable in this position. It's, now it is stopped moving here and there. And from the right side, from this bigger sheath only, we have taken another MP with a snare. And we have snared the screw after this. The moment we got the hold of this device and we put the device back onto the sheath, we were so excited, including our cath lab technician, that he forgot to record that event. But finally we get this time is this, that we have the device out. After this, echo were done to see any tricuspid valve injury or any other issue, any complication, and a venogram done to rule out any vascular injury. After this, the case was retried with 20 mm device, the same technique, and was successful enough to do this case with 28 mm device. After check echo, we have released the device, and this is a echo on discharge. And this is the
hello
photo of the girl went scarless. Lesson learned in this case, we are in learning phase. We are just 2 years old, our center is 2 years old, and we have just done only 54 cases of ASD. So this the lesson was in whenever this IVC remained doubtful. Like in this case, the IVC was floppy. So at least 4 mm larger device should be taken. What we have done, the maximum diameter was 24, and initially we have taken 26 mm device. But finally, we have taken 28. There is no need to be panic. Large ASD device can be done, can be retrieved back in cath lab, provided you have intention to try it again. And if you don't want to try it by device, it's better to send surgery. Thank you so much. And finally, this case lined up into all is well. All in well. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Dr. Tin, you are about to tell something, Dr. Tin.
Yeah, a very interesting procedure. You cross the small wire in the snare and make the device stable, and you can catch the screw and you can remove the devices. The biggest device you can retrieve, how big is this?
26 of them.
26, okay. But Shiva and Bharat, maybe you can retrieve the bigger one. The biggest one I retrieve is 38. But the main problem is the the device inside the RV. But I think Bharat, you can show them how to bring the device from RV to RA, maybe more safer. If we cross the guide wire through the device and it entangling with the tracker switch valve and boomer valve is a big problem. And when we snare it, it's a big problem. It's not easy to bring it back again.
Yeah.
Bharat, you can share.
Yeah, definitely. It's not a pulmonary valve, it's tricuspid valve, well, definitely. So probably the steps that we have to ensure will be to make a broader loop when we are trying to enter the tricuspid valve orifice with the catheter forming loop or a J guide wire and enter into the right ventricle. Then advance this inner 418 wire. I think your pod is dragging all the way, and if you have dragged a bunch of tricuspid valve cording, you will have a significant problem. Your point is very well taken, and Dr. Kamran already mentioned that his point of like taking a 26 millimeter for a 24 millimeter ASD was not correct. I think that is the final message. The sizing has to be correct. Edwin?
Two quick points. Unfortunately, this old is a baby or a, she's an older child. Nah? So we could have very well done a D. When you're doing the first few cases, like 50 or 100, it's better you have a transistor in a co. Make sure the rims before you proceed, or at least during the intra procedure. Mm-hmm. Second point, it's more easier to use a vascular retrieval forceps. It happened this time. You take a vascular retrieval forceps, ask your technician to get one, and then fix the device with that, and then have another access retrieval. Rather than, it's far easier and quicker to do with the vascular retrieval forceps.
I could not agree with you, Edwin, when you are doing, could not agree with you more, because when you are doing first few cases, I think having a transesophageal echo is extremely important before you standardize. And second thing is, yes, stabilizing the device is everything, and never try to snare from the right ventricle where there are chances of you traumatizing the tricuspid valve. So there are various techniques of bringing the device back into the right atrium and stabilizing either with a bioptom or a forceps is a great idea.
For the question that was raised by Dr. Tin, Dr. Kannan from Madurai has written that he has retrieved a 40 millimeter device. Let me tell you, I have retrieved a 46 millimeter device. We have published recently in the larger, more than 40 millimeter device data. A 46 millimeter device who developed a restrictive LV physiology, at the end of 24 hours, we had to go in. We used an 18 French Cook-Mullin sheath and snared it. All large devices are very difficult to retrieve. Thanks a lot.
My question to you, Shiva, after retrieving 46 millimeter device, what did you do? You put in 48.
No. That patient had a restrictive LV physiology. It is published in the CAT CVI. I mentioned that the patient deteriorated because of restrictive LV. So our intention was to take out.
Okay.
I'll share this paper with you.
Look, Neeraj, you can share the screen.
Yeah, thank you. The next speaker is Dr. Neeraj Awasthi.
Yeah.
Is it Dr. Neeraj?
Yeah. Hello. Yeah. Hello, sir. Am I visible?
Yeah.
Am I visible and audible?
You're visible and audible.
So, morning, everybody. I'd like to share my interesting case of a right ventricular outflow tract stenting, and which has been done in this COVID times. It was done on around 20, I think, the very day there was a lockdown, just one day prior to it. So to introduce, RUOT stenting is gradually evolving alternative, clinically described for VSD, PS physiology, that is retrology physiology. I'll be discussing for a case of tricuspid atresia VSD, PS, and tackling this particular case in these corona times. It was a newborn child. He was delivered in a place 100 kilometers from Delhi, that is Bulandshahr.
PowerPoint is not seen. Yes.
PowerPoint.
Can you make it slice?
My PowerPoint is not visible?
No.
Computer screen PowerPoint. Are you distant all that? Go to a slideshow probably.
Is it visible now?
Yeah. Yes.
Is it visible?
Please go ahead.
Thank you. Sorry for the inconvenience. We had this newborn child who was delivered almost 100 kilometers from Delhi in Bulandshahr. He was full-term, normal vaginal delivery, cried immediately after birth with a birth weight of 3.6 kgs. Developed tachypnea within a few hours of birth. Sepsis screen was positive, was started on IV antibiotics and oxygen. And a local cardiology consult was taken on day 3, which was diagnosed as tetralogy with the ASD and was referred to us. Now, this is the scenario when the COVID times, the lockdown has been announced in the evening. All of the traffic is going to work outside Delhi with people also walking, and there's a lot of commotion on the road, and this patient is coming against this traffic with his friend's car. Naturally, at the time of presentation, he is presented to a nursery. His saturation is 45. The patient baby is tachypneic and a hypothermic. Patient is stabilized, rewarmed. Oxygen continues to be 40 to 50%, but the child is reasonably comfortable. So we decided to give a trial of prostaglandin, withdraw the oxygen, optimize the patient, gave vitamin K, and started on beta blockers. Meanwhile, a positive COVID case has been taken to the cath lab, and the cath lab is getting fumigated. This is how the patient's father looked like, a similar appeal. And whenever you understand the patient who is carrying all the gadgets, the COVID has just started, the first thing which comes to the mind is, oh, he has traveled, he must be COVID positive. So this was the reaction of the cath lab. He must be COVID positive. But luckily, there was no travel history in this patient. COVID test is not available. It is available at only one center in this particular day. But naturally, the alarm was about the cath lab was, what if we are the source of COVID for this hospital? So after taking all the precautions, the echo is done. It is situs solitus, ligocardia. This is a large multifenestrated ASD. It's a case of tricuspid atresia, normally irritated vessels. VSD is sort of moderate size, which is situated posteriorly. It's a posterior muscular VSD. There is a severe pulmonary stenosis, which is predominantly subvalvular, not at the VSD level, to be. This is a tiny antegrade flow, the confluent pulmonary arteries, bilateral SVC with a normal ventricular function. So the plan option would be either to go for a BT shunt. Our unit policy for all newborn babies, we are essentially going for PDA stenting or the right ventricular outflow tract ballooning or stenting. And of course, that particular day is the when our hospital has been made a COVID hospital. Pediatric CTVS ICU has been converted to COVID ICU, and we are shifted to the next building. So practically, we don't have our own ICU setup for a postoperative care. PDA stent, well, we tried the prostaglandin, no PDA is seen. We could have gone in, injected and demonstrated and tried to decanalize it. That is one of the options. But we decided to go for a RVOT stent. For a RVOT stent, in this particular case, either I take a venous loop or I take an arterial loop. Remember, it's a tricuspid atresia. For a venous loop, the SVC or IVC, the usual course going into the route and ventricular tract, the advantage would be that I would be able to take a larger sheath. For aortic root, this is a small child who has already stayed in the nursery for 4 days. And I would only go with a smaller arterial sheath. Literature shows no description of a tricuspid atresia, how to manage it. Maybe there are personal experiences, but we could not, except for one publication by Oliver, which talks of one case they haven't done a tricuspid atresia with no detailed description as to how we do in case of a tricuspid atresia. This is our anesthesia. The same day the photo has been taken. This is the first PPE which has been used in the hospital. He's in the full PPE attire. Vascular access was tried and ultrasound guidance. We could take a femoral vein with ultrasound guidance. The femoral vein could not be taken because he was in the nursery and it has already been pricked for IV medications. So umbilical, well, it was one of the choices, but it had been a difficult course. we decided we could get a IJV, which was a 5 French. And he did give us a left femoral artery, telling us that it was difficult to go, and it just looks very small for a 4 French sheet. But yes, 4 French sheet was 10. So he gave a 22 gauge scanner line, the femoral artery, and told us it was small. Intubate the patient and went under general anesthesia for the procedure. So LV angiogram was done from the SVC into the LV. There you see a small antegrade flow, which is seen from the VSD, antegradely, which is seen here. I could not retrieve the echoes from the unit because, as I told you earlier, our unit has become a COVID unit and the echo lab, a pediatric echo lab, is as of now closed. We don't have an access to previous echoes. So here I would try to tell that the distance between this particular distance from the RV, hypoplastic RV, to this was coming out to be 14 millimeters on the echocardiography, and this is coming out to be 16 mm on the angiogram. So our choice was to go, since it's a univentricular pathway, to go for somewhere like 23 millimeters, because I can take a small, slightly bigger length being a univentricular pathway. I'm not worried about much about RVOT, and try to cover off the whole of this infundibular part. But the problem was how to go. We tried to go antegrade because we wanted to take a bigger sheath. We can take the things easily. But remember, I am going from an anterior SVC to a right atrium to a posterior LA, then coming anteriorly into the left ventricle, trying to go into the posterior muscular VSD, then into the anterior aorta. So that was definitely a difficult course, and obviously we were not able to manage anteriorly. So I am at house working in my hardware. This is the kitchen where is my present workspace is. And just to demonstrate, I have used this banana as the SVC. And there you see my daily hardware which I use, the banana, the dough, which is as a catheter. It has to go, dough is the catheter. So it has go from the SVC, it has to come anteriorly, then go posteriorly into the LV, come anteriorly. Well, dough could not have gone inside this. So it has to go posteriorly, and then it has to go into the RVOT. Dough can easily stuck to this RVOT banana, but catheter wires cannot. So I thank my wife, who is cutting my hair, when she knew I'm presenting in 400 audience. She decided to give me a haircut on this COVID day yesterday. So this particular catheter course was definitely difficult. So we decided to go retrograde. So from the 22 cast cannula is now upgraded to a 4 French sheath. Well, the choice could have been a 5 French. The difference is that a 4 French and a 5 French radial sheath would be 0.43 versus 0.75, and the anesthesia has a concern that it's a very smaller artery. So we initially went with the RCA, with the wire-only technique, have crossed it with a thermo wire, and we crossed into the RVOT. But we could not negotiate any catheter from the aorta into the LV, into the posterior VSD, into the RVOT, except for this glide catheter, a 4 French glide catheter, because I am there with the O35 thermo wire, and I need a support O14 wire for my stent. So we could definitely, but as we pull out this wire, this particular glide catheter would repeatedly kink. So we decided to use a body wire. So we could manage with the coronary wire, which passed in. We passed another whisper softer wire with retrogradely into the pulmonary artery. But my main concern was that we are across this VSD. It's a posterior VSD, and a bundle is running anterior to it. And this O15, which is a very thin wire, can easily, because it can easily cut through this, being a very thinner wire. So as I was pushing this stent, I just pulled out the wire because I was very afraid of cutting a heart block. Another thing was the concern was, of course, bringing this particular stent into the VSD. If I have to bring it to the VSD, the same phenomena, it's going to press on anteriorly. I'm going anteriorly from the aorta. It's going to press anteriorly as I inflate, and is likely possibility I can cause a heart block. So I have to, and VSD is pretty moderate size, so I can keep it slightly distal to the VSD. So that was the issue. The change of plan here was, since we were not able to negotiate, we went through a 4 French. I could have gone, there's no guide to support. I had to go bare, as we do for many of our PDS stents. Going bare means that instead of a 23 millimeter stent, which it could be in a longer, negotiating across the
track, we decided to decrease the size and used an 18 millimeter Zions Expedition stent. So it was gradually inflated as we inflate this particular stent. And this is the final flow. Definitely, there is a small infundibular component, if you see here, which is still there. The saturations on board has gone from 40 to 85%. The child is reasonably comfortable at this particular trace. Initially, I wanted to put in another stent, but since the saturations are good, the child is comfortable, it was decided that I'll back off. So I generally backed off because the saturations went on to 85%. So before the patient was discharged, the post-procedure, the most important times in COVID times is to use this particular gadget again, to do a hand washing again after you come out, not just before going in. So we discharge the child on 2 days later. He's accepting feeds, a saturation of 80-85%. And beta blockers, this particular area on echo looked very widely open, so the flow is good. And this time the child was taken back on ambulance. Why on ambulance? Because on the way, it's a lockdown, and with a car, he would have trouble. So he decided to go with the ambulance so that he can reach the home safely. Learning points, it was optimization of the baby, which is very important because of, I think, optimization, hypothermia, which is controlled, giving vitamin K so that coagulation.
Yes, nearly 9 minutes.
So,
thank you, Anirudh. That was a wonderful presentation. The path of track from the left ventricle through the VSD through the right ventricular outflow tract would have been far more favorable if it had been a femoral venous route. So would you have considered, after you got the jugular access, pass a guide wire down into one of the femoral veins? You told right femoral vein is occluded, but pass it into the left femoral vein and try to use that as the landmark and get a venous puncture, because it actually tracks very well if you are going from the femoral vein to RA, LA, LV, and RV. And in some of the patients, we had actually put in 5 into 28 millimeter stent on a similar situation in order to provide a much bigger Sano-like shunt on the same tricuspid atresia. So 5 into 28, that goes through a 5-French guide catheter. But it is easier to manipulate if you are going from the femoral vein. So did you consider trying for a femoral venous access when through your jugular try to find out whether there was a femoral vein?
So we didn't actually try from the femoral. We just tried it beforehand. But once the excess IGV was there, we just tried the IGV and went to plan B. Being a new nate, we were really skeptical to take all these hypothermia 5-day-old child. We could have tried that. So that's a good
in the story. Chat box, many people were appreciating your banana dough model.
I just wanted to make one comment. You know, somehow I feel that we as pediatric cardiologists, I don't know the experience all over the country, you may be well aware of it, but my feeling is that we as pediatric cardiologists have still not mastered the art of accessing vessels in neonates with the help of ultrasound. I think we should be doing it more and more, and we should be doing it routinely. Only then it will be easy to access it in case of difficulties. You know, even in Kannan's case, I saw that we have to be far more aggressive in getting vascular access with ultrasound. And those centers who do it, they are able to do it in any amount of, I mean, you see that Satanam, who does it in 500.
Okay, we can start a trial wherein we can subgroup cardiologists between 30 to 40, 40 to 50, 50 to 60, 60 to 70, and find out what is the steepness of the learning curve of a person for vascular ultrasound guided vascular access in each and every age group. And maybe that's a good thing to look at.
I don't mind being a part of it.
Yeah, thank you. That was a wonderful case, Dr. Neeraj. We enjoyed. And in view of time, I'm requesting the next speaker, Dr. Shad Akbari, from again Aligarh University, to go ahead with his presentation.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, sure,
yeah. Go ahead. Okay, sir. Hello, Admin, sir. Respected teachers and dear colleagues, greetings from Aligarh. I'm presenting my presentation. The 2-year-old male referred from a district called Jalalabad, Khanjapur, which is quite far from Aligarh. It's almost 300 kilometers. And has been referred as a case of CHD with history of bliss discoloration, which was noticed since neonatal period with repeated episodes of cyanotic spells. When the child presented to us was having a heart rate of 148 with a saturation of 72%, and there is a faint ejection systolic murmur in the chest, but there were no extra cardiac issues. It was an X-ray. ECG was and there was nothing, but there was some right axis deviation. The echo showed a large coronaventricular VSD with very minimal anticoagulant flows across the RVOT. So, detailed echo evaluation showed a large unrestricted VSD with minimal anticoagulant flows. But what is very concerning was the very small branch pulmonary arteries with a Z-score of less than minus 2.5. So we have a case of tetralogy of Fallot with a very small branch VS, with unfavorable branch VS anatomy. And the child became very symptomatic and while gone into spell in during the process of echo itself. And we immediately started on fluid versus injection, ketamine was started and morphine infusion started. So we had a situation, a very grave situation at hand, and definitely the definitive repair is not possible. So we thought of a palliation. Beatician was the ideal thing. And there's, of course, the thought of a right ventricular outflow tract stenting. So unfortunately, in our center, because it's been started recently only, we had not a very good outcome patients with BD shunt. But on the other hand, also, we have very limited experience on RVOT. I think this was the second case if we had been attempted for RVOT stent. So, and this, or you all know that there's a steep learning curve for this procedure and patients are quite sick. So we took that plunge and shifted the child to the cath lab with this saturation. So, and child immediately intubated, stabilized, accesses was taken, and this was the angiogram, which shows a diminutive branch pulmonary arteries and very minimal anticoagulant flows, which I'm seeing. This was another angiogram, which shows small branch VS, branch pulmonary arteries, hypoplastic. And we tried to cross the RVOT with the coronary wire. Luckily, with few attempts, we were able to cross it, but no other catheter was crossing across the RVOT. So we utilized the glide, cross it. And once we have exchanged with the stiffer wire, we were not able to negotiate the guide. So we thought of putting the stent as a bearer without the support of the guide. And we take in a 8x27mm peripheral stent across the RVOT and subsequently dilated it. And the stent was deployed. And it attained a very stable position. So we were very pretty happy that we have achieved our result. Then subsequently, the full assembly complex was taken out. And this was the final angiogram after the deployment of the stent. We initially thought that we have missed some part of the infundibular area, but since the saturation level shifted to the ICU, and we were pretty satisfied that we have achieved our results. The child was doing well, for the saturation in the ICU, but after 2 hours, the ABGs and saturations were holding on, and we were thought that the job has been done. But then overnight, the child has repeated episodes of saturation, which is fluctuating from 30s to 80s, and the child's rhythm was also changing in between going to a right ventral blind box. And in the morning, this was the ABG with showing low, very low PO2s with lactase, which is rising, and very low saturations. So we had a situation of persistent acidosis with high lactates with very low PO2. EC showed intermittently junctional rhythm with right ventral branch block. ECHO showed good anticoagulant flows, but we were very skeptical that we have missed some part of the infundibular area. We have decided to take the child for the cath lab again. And this time the crossing of the RVOT was really a nightmare. It almost took us almost 2.5 hours to really cross the RVOT. We were empty, like whatever, nothing was traversing some RVOT, and luckily in this one of the attempts, we were able to ride 20 kilowatt full track across the distance. And then subsequently, we were able to deploy another tent across the previous tent, overlapping almost half of it. And this time, and you guys initially thought that was not being covered by the stent, and that's the second one.
Satya, you want to go to the...
Yeah, we've lost the connection from him.
Satya, can you unmute Chad? I think it's not...
Right, 1 second.
Go ahead, Edwin, with your comments.
No, it's beautifully done, but you can see the final thing. It's pretty good work done here. But only thing, if you have enough time, it's better do a good echocardiogram before you deploy the stent. So it'd be better to know exactly what is the position of the stent. Can get angio as well as an echo guidance during the deployment of the stent.
Yeah. Sure. My only comment was that they deployed the stent without having any angiographic guidance. They don't have a guide catheter. They don't have another venous access to exactly know where they are positioning the stent. So the chances of missing the narrowest portion is going to be definitely more than if they would have had any other way of knowing where they are positioning the stent.
Satyesh, that Shah could be unmuted, is it?
No, I think when I'm trying to unmute also, it's not getting unmuted.
Then we will go to the next speaker and come back to it later to the end of the session. Not audible.
Yes. Then the next speaker is Dr. Sanjeevan Ghosh. Yeah. Am I audible and visible?
Very much.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Today I'm going to present a case of bilateral branch pulmonary artery stenting following a complex biventricular repair. I'm Dr. Sanjeevan Ghosh from Narayana Super Speciality Hospital, Howrah. So this is a story of a 12-year-old boy weighing 23 kg who underwent a modified Nikaido procedure. That is in the form of aortic group translocation with LV2 aorta tunneling, and we placed a conduit, 18 millimeter contact valve conduit in the RVOT. And it was done for a TGA VSD with a pulmonary stenosis, and the branch PAs were borderline. The RPA Z score was minus 2 and the LPA 0 was minus 0.7. The location of the VSD was remote, so we couldn't go for a rascally or rape kind of procedure. So the surgery went well. The child got discharged on 8th post-operative day, but the child came back within 2 months, and he presented with recurrent right-sided pleural effusion with RV systolic dysfunction. In the echocardiography, we got bilateral branch pulmonary artery stenosis. Am I audible clearly?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, sure. So looking back, these are the pre-operative angiogram. This is the RV angiogram. You can see there is a large subaortic conus and the remote location of the VSD. This is the injection in the MAPKA. Retrogradely, the branch PAs are getting failed. So you can appreciate the hypoplastic branch PA. This is the preoperative CT scan showing IP of 8.5 millimeter and LPA of 9.5 millimeter. So these are the postoperative echo clippings. After 2 months postoperative, you can appreciate the bilateral branch PA origin stenosis. The RPA is still at the origin, and the LPA origin is good, but it got stenosed beyond 5 millimeter. Like after 5 millimeter from the origin, it is getting stenosed. And the main cause of stenosis is getting pushed by compressed by this dilated ascending aorta. Four chamber view showing mild RV dysfunction, moderate tricuspid regurgitation, and the TR gradient of near 100. So this is the postoperative CT scan. You can appreciate the PA, confluence stenosis here. We have freeze the image. This is the RPA and this is the LPA. Both the branch PAs are getting compressed by the dilated aorta. So we planned for a RVOP stenting, bilateral branch pulmonary artery stenting. There is some problem. Okay, so we face. This is not a native, normally oriented RVOT. This is a post-Nikaido RVOT. So the orientation of the RVOT is different. Again, it is post-Likamte maneuver. So the orientation of the PA confluence is different. In post-Likamte, the PAs will be hugging the aorta and the aorta will be wedged in between the PAs. So while putting the stent, there is a chance of compression on the ascending aorta. Again, we did a modified Nikaido procedure. So we harvested the coronary buttons. And we have re-implanted much anteriorly. So we feel there is a small chance of coronary compression while putting the stent in the branch pulmonary artery. And then we put a Contegra conduit, and it's a valve conduit. And the valve is very thin and flimsy. So we felt while manipulating the catheter in the pulmonary artery, the valve can get damaged. Another challenge was selecting the proper stent. The radial strength should be good because this is the dilated aorta which is compressing the branch pulmonary artery. So the stent, at least the stent has to withstand the compressive force of the aorta. Then the trackability. The trackability should be very good because it's a very unusual orientation of the branch pulmonary artery. And the future redialectability should be there. Another problem we face, lack of available literature. I believe operator must have done this procedure before, but in best of my knowledge, I didn't get any case reports or any publication. So it didn't have the guidance from the literature also. Anyway, we took up the case in cath lab and we did the cath. As you can see, the RV pressure was suprasystemic. It was 120% of the systemic pressure. There was no gradient across the conduit. And we are injecting in the pulmonary artery. We avoided taking any pressure injection just to avoid the damage to the valve. We did injection in the ileocranial, ileocaudal, and epicaudal view. As you can see here, the RPA is stenosed near the origin. And the LPA is, and the stenosis segment we measured 16 millimeters. The LPA is stenosis, but the origin was quite good. And beyond 5 millimeters, the part is stenosis over a area over a span of 25 millimeters. So we decided to go ahead with a Cook formula saying 18 to 20 millimeter for the RPA and 18 to 30 millimeter for the LPA. Okay, so we crossed the LPA with a 6-trench braided sheath and we parked a 035 ultra stiff wire in the LPA. For the RPA, we selected a 7-trench guiding catheter and we parked a coronary wire distal. Then we have taken a 18-20 418 series stent for the RPA and 18-30mm 535 series stent for the LPA. We made the stent unsheathed and we are taking the final position of the stent with a hand injection through the side arm of the braided sheath. Now we are inflating the LPA stent first, and then we are inflating the RPA stent sequentially. We avoided a simultaneous inflation because this is not a confluence stenosis. So we have the liberty to do it. And this is the end result. The stents are nicely flowing. You can see this is the final position of the stent. You can appreciate the shape of the aorta here. So there is no recoiling. So it's withstanding the compressive force of the aorta. And the final numbers, the RV pressure becomes 40% of the systemic. From the PA diastolic pressure of 6, so there was not much PR. And the PA mean pressure of 19 millimeter of mercury. These are the final echocardiography clipping. the laminar flow through the branch PAs. You can see there is almost like hollow diastolic flow reversal, but there was not much pulmonary regurgitation. As you can see here, this is the valve of the conduit, and it's nicely coapting. We believe the NPA segment was usually dilated, some swelling of the blood inside the branch pulmonary arteries. So what may be the causes of branch PA stenosis in this particular case? Branch PAs were very, very borderline from the very beginning. Was it a wrong selection of case? Then branch pulmonary artery stenosis is very well known post Licomte because the PAs tend to get stretched against the aorta. Again, post Licomte, if the wedge dissection of the aorta is inadequate, then there is a chance of branch PA stenosis. We believe all these three factors must have contributed for developing branch pulmonary artery stenosis. But is it really a bad selection of case? What are the other possible options we had? Rascal or rape procedure, but the location of the VSD was remote, so the aorta was not rootable to the LV. So this there was no chance scope for this. Single ventricle palliation, again the branch PAs were borderline. For a successful single ventricle palliation, the PA pressure and the PA anatomy are the main determining factors. So it was not, the scope was not there. Medical management, I don't believe there was any scope because 12-year-old boy, failure to thrive, severely cyanosed plus three symptoms, there was no scope, and we believe aortic root translocation was the only possible option for this particular child. So this was a very challenging case. This is a perfect example of a great teamwork. Our surgical team has done a really great job to make this make the modified Nikaido procedure for this such a hypoplastic branch pulmonary artery, and our cardiology team have augmented their work by doing a complex bilateral branch PA stenting. I would like to acknowledge Dr. Amitabh Chattopadhyay, who is our HOD, my colleague Dr. Joita Das Nandi, and Dr. Deva Siddharth, who is our surgeon. Thank you.
Excellent. Excellent question. And one of the questions from Malaysia was, how do you exclude a future erosion of this stent into the aorta? It's a known problem in post Lecomte patients when you have a high pressure stent on the pulmonary arteries. It slowly erodes through after a longer time of period, and you get an aorta to PA fistula, which has been managed by covered stents in the past. I mean, that was one of the questions of the
back. It's a possibility. Definitely, sir, it's a possibility. We have to see the follow-up.
Excellent. Excellent management.
And, I had one question, Shiva.
Yes, sir.
In your discussion, you said that you were little concerned about coronary compression, but I never saw you do any kind of testing before you deployed your
stent. We did.
It's a valid consideration, and I think you should do a definite interrogation of the coronaries before you get the stent.
Sir, we did actually.
Okay, but you didn't show.
Yeah, I didn't show it because we are balloon testing. Like we did a coronary angio before that. That was the concern.
One other reason why we can bypass that will be if we, on CT scan, if the two branch pulmonary arteries are a much higher level, far higher than the level of coronary ostia, then it is fine. But it is
sir, actually, it was not that higher. That was the concern. We interrogated the CT scan also. It was not looking that away. That's why we did a balloon interrogation. We did a dilatation in the pulmonary arteries. And we did a coronary angiogram. I didn't show it actually.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Thank you. We request Dr. Amir Rashid from Srinagar to share his experiences. We are already seeing the slide.
I'm not getting. Yes. Am I audible and visible?
Very well. Yes.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'll be presenting a case of a period-wise closure which was complicated by severe hemolysis, which we managed by transcatheter retrieval and deployment of a new device. I am Dr. Amir Rashid. I'm currently working as assistant professor in cardiology at Sher E Kashmir Institute of Medical Sciences. This is the photograph of our institute, which is the largest tertiary care center in JNK, and perhaps the only major center which caters to the pediatric cardiac services of the state. My slides are not moving, sorry.
You go down to the last, there is a left, right arrow button. Go and click on the right arrow button.
That's what I'm clicking, sir.
Take it to the left lower corner.
It was just working, I don't know. So it's
not. Or you can use the normal arrow keys.
Yeah, escape the slideshow and then go to the slide.
Okay. not getting escape.
No, just take it to the lower corner and click on the right arrow. Go down, take that arrow down.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, move the arrow down, left lower corner, not the right lower. Left. Press on the right button, not that button. The next, correct.
Just okay, thank you. Thank you so much. So I'll be presenting to you a case of a 52-year-old gentleman who was diagnosed as a case of large PDA. Clinically, the chant was more than 2:1. And he had moderate PH clinically. He had the complaint of functional class 2 dyspnea on exertion. He was in sinus rhythm. There was no clinical heart failure. He had systemic hypertension. ECG, as we can see, shows LV volume overload pattern with deep QAs in second, third AVF and V5, V6. X-ray shows features of a large shunt with cardiomegaly and increased pulmonary blood flow. ECHO showed a large 10 millimeters PDA at the PAM, the dilated LALV and moderate PH, RVSP of 60 plus RA with some mild AR. So we plan to do a cath with device closure. The cath data showed a saturation run of SVC of 70%, IVC 72%, PA showed was 94%, aortic saturation was 100%. So there was a significant step up of around 20% from the SVC IVC to the pulmonary artery. The PA pressures, there was moderate PAH, pulmonary artery was 55, the 30 mean was 42. The patient had significant hypertension with systolic pressure of 210 and a wide pulse pressure of diastolic pressure of 60. The QPQ was more than 2:1. So we thought it's a routine PDA, large PDA with moderate PH, and we'll close it with a usual PDA device. So this is the angle in the RAO view, in which view it was best profile, showing a large PDA with a good ampulla. The PDA measured around 10 millimeters at the PA end. So we oversized the device by about 4 millimeters. So we thought a largest ADO1 available was 16:14. So we went ahead with the 16:14 ADO2 and deployed the device. This is the RAO view showing the device. However, we were not happy with the aortic end of the disc, which was not fully formed, but we tried multiple times to change, got hold the device back and redeployed it. This is the lateral view showing again the aortic disc was not formed as normally is in PDA when we put a PDA device. So, every time we tried, it was somehow taking the same shape. So we gave a good tug and it looked quite stable. So on the angiogram, though, we can see there was a good amount of residual flow, but we thought since the device is stable, so this we took this residual to be through the device and we released the device. This is the echo picture, which showed the device was in situ, but there was a significant residual in the device. But this echo actually we did after releasing the device. By this time, we had already released the device. So we thought that this residual will come down as the device gets thrombosed. However, the next day when we went for the rounds, the patient had a continuous murmur, and you can see this is bedside picture of his urine, which he had collected a gross hematuria, and we repeated his echo that showed significant residual shunt. So initially we thought that it will come down, so we tried to manage conservatively. However, his pre-procedure hemoglobin was 14.1, which decreased to 6.2 over 10 days, and his pre-procedure creatinine was 0.2, and after 10 days it increased to 1.9. His bilirubin increased to 3.5, LDH increased to 3000, and urine showed granular cast and hemoglobin urea. So now after 10 days of managing him with conservatively with IV fluids and supportive treatment and alkalization, he did not show any signs of improvement. So we discussed with the surgeons for possible surgical removal of this device, but the patient was not keen, and there were concerns with the surgery as the patient was elderly and he had anemia with renal failure, and probably the surgeons needed to go on a bypass to remove this device. And then there was option of transcatheter route, which was either to retrieve the device, which we had never done, or to put the coils, a peri device or intra device. We did not have much experience of using the coils while there's a device in situ, and whether to put them around the device or in the device. And there were concerns of whether fiddling with the device will cause embolization of the device. So what we thought that we will try to retrieve the device and meanwhile keep the surgeons informed. The same day, if we are not successful in retrieving the device, we'll send the patient for surgical closure. So these are the still images. We went ahead with the 11 French Moulin sheath over a platysis stiffware across the RVOT into MPA. then it shows the same image when the dilator is removed. Initially, what we tried, we inside the larger Lamson sheet, we put an RCA guide, and we put the usual PDA cable inside that guide so that we could just screw that the cable to directly screw the device. We tried multiple times, but as soon as the cable was coming out of the RCA guide, it was getting straightened up and it was very stiff and it was not aligning with the device. So that idea we gave up of directly screwing the device. Then we used multiple catheters. We used RCA guide, RCA catheter. This is a CLS catheter. These are different RAO views of various catheters, MPA catheters. We tried for around 1 or 2 hours. It was not helping, and we were even ready for shifting the patient to the OT. In fact, we arranged the trolley, but suddenly God was very kind to us. The screw got somehow entangled into the, sorry, the snare got somehow entangled into the screw within the 10 millimeters snare with a MPA catheter, and we just withdrew the device. And we can see how the disc looks like now and what was it inside the inside when it was inside the PDA. And then after that, we just pulled it into the sheet. Now there was further questions. Now what should be done now? The patient was pretty annoyed with us. He was around 55 years of age, and he had lived his life quite comfortably. And for the last 10 days, we had given him anemia, renal failure, blood transfusions. So it was very difficult to persuade the patient for further treatment, but there was a significant shunt with moderate PH. We offered him surgical closure in the lab. We told him we'll shift, but he was not ready at all. So finally, we again counseled him and his family, and we told him that we'll try with another type of a device. And if we are sure that there is no residual, then only we'll release the device. So we went ahead with, after discussing with my seniors, we went ahead with a double disc 14 muscular VSD device. We wanted to use somewhat a 16, but we did not have that time. So we went ahead with a 14 device and we deployed it. The shape of the device looked good. And though there was a residual flow still through the device, but echo at the time of before releasing the cable was very convincing. There was a very little residual flow, which we normally accept at the end of the device. So we waited for half an hour before the release of device. And once we were sure that the device, that the residual is very less, it's not a significant residual, then we release the device. After this, the patient was kept for some more days in the hospital. His hemoglobin improved and his renal failure improved. He was discharged after 2 days and he's on follow-up for 6 months. He's doing fine. So what I learned from the device is that perhaps systemic blood pressure should be optimally controlled before planning device. Our patient had a blood pressure of 210 at the time of device, which remained high after the first device. And probably the ADO1 device should not be released if the aortic end of the disc is not fully formed. Somehow I think the thrombogenicity of the device gets decreased. And patients should be carefully monitored for hemolysis if there is evidence of residual shunt, and should be given treated with IV fluids and blood transfusion. If conservative treatment fails, device needs to be retrieved. Transcatheter retrieval, although technically challenging, is a feasible treatment and can avoid surgery, which in this condition requires a cardiopulmonary bypass. And muscular VSD device is a good alternative to usual PDA device, especially in adults. And after darkest nights come the brightest days. This is the picture of the tulip garden here in Srinagar, which is Asia's largest tulip garden and is situated some 4 kilometers from where I live. So I, though now it is in its full bloom, but unfortunately there's nobody to see it. I invite all of you once the bright days come back to please visit this place. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Amir. We enjoyed it. I would like Dr. Satya to get Dr. Ko. He is from Selangor, Malaysia. Dr. Ko, G-H-E-E-K-O-H. If possible, just open him out, his camera and his audio. Quite a versatile interventional cardiologist from Selangor, Malaysia.
Yes, Ivan. What can I do for you? I'm just about to go off. Yeah, what can I do for you?
Any comments?
Yeah, actually, I think that initial the impression of the device is not conforming very nice. I'm actually very worried to kind of release the device from the initial deployment. So I would actually use a muscular VSD device which can conform nicely as a start. Yeah, but sometimes it's just during that particular moment, it is a very difficult decision to make during that time.
Dr. Bharat?
I wanted to make two or three comments. First is I completely agree with Dr. Goh that if you leave the device, hemolysis is one part, but with such a significant systemic hypertension, the other problem is embolization. The second thing is that in adult PDA of this size, it is always advisable to oversize significantly. So using a 20 by 18 or maybe even a larger device would have been advisable. And the third comment I wanted to make was, after retrieving this device, if you have to use another device and going with a 14 millimeter muscular VSD, which again is a borderline device, would not have been a great idea. And this is not an emergency. So you could have waited for a 16 or a 18 millimeter device to come, if not muscular post MI, and then used it. And lastly, remember that these devices can also be removed from the aortic end. It is not necessary that you have to remove them from the pulmonary end. Especially in adults, you can use a bioptome to grasp the aortic end of the disc and re-slenderize the device in a reverse fashion.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Bharat. In my talk on large PDA, I was mentioning, this is quite common to find huge PDAs in Himalayas. I have gone to Srinagar quite often, and I have surprised to see that many of the PDAs will be massive like this.
All these high altitudes tend to have it.
Yeah, we look forward, Dr. Srinivas, one of the wonderful interventionists from Mumbai, on this nightmare from PDA. We are seeing you, and your slides are.
Thank you, sir. I would like to present our experience with preterm PDA devices that we did and a recent complication that we faced in cath lab. Okay, so this is the data so far. 2017 onwards, we have done about 9 patients, preterm babies who have weighed less than 2 kilos. Most of these are the smallest in the country. So today with this experience, what has actually helped us doing these PDA devices more commonly lately is availability of ADO2 AS device. So this is being called as Piccolo device now. So this is the indications for intervention for us. So if you see, most of the patients have failed to thrive after births. Usually our policy is to do PDA device closures only after 6 months if the patients are asymptomatic. So here all these patients were symptomatic, so we had to do the PDA device closure earlier. Last two patients were the sickest for us. Both of them were oxygen dependent and were ventilated and were unable to wean off from the ventilator. So this is the anatomy of the duct. As you can see, most of the ducts are tubular in a preterm baby. All of them had at least moderate to severe pulmonary hypertension. Uniformly, everybody had LV dilatation. None of them had any significant associated cardiac lesions. So how we do these procedures is we don't take any arterial access in any of the babies. That has been our policy even for larger patients. We do only sheath angiograms. We do not use sheath angiography for assessing the size of the PDA. So all the PDA sizes are assessed based on echocardiography. Sheath angiograms are only for landmarks. And we use extensive intraoperative echocardiography to assess the deployment of the device and post-release evaluation. So this was one of the twin baby. 26 weeks, 820 grams, one of the twin ventilated on day one and surfactant was given as per protocol. Day three, he was found to have a large PDA on echocardiography. So conservative management, FiO2 fluctuated between 21 to 30%. Day five, baby developed edema, renal failure, serum lactate was 1.8. Ultrasonography showed medical renal disease, which is non-specific. Day 10, baby further deteriorated, serum albumin was 1.2 now. Serum creatinine was 2.0. The pediatrician has already tried paracetamol for this baby to close the PDA. Day 14 continues to deteriorate. FiO2 now increased to 35%, increasing the oxygen requirement. Edema is increasing. One dose of ibuprofen was given on top of paracetamol. Serum creatinine fluctuates between 1.4 to 1.2. There is marginal reduction in the pulmonary arteries, PDA size. Day 20, still, so nothing happens. The PDA remains large and all the hemodynamic features of PDA are still present. Pediatrician, in spite of having 1.8 creatinine, has gone ahead and given second dose of ibuprofen. So in spite of all these things, the PDA did not respond to conservative management and we had to go in and do the intervention. So this is during the initial days. As you can see, there is not much of LV dilatation in this baby. So as the days progressed, there was progressive dilatation of the left atrium and the left ventricle, and this baby started to become more and more symptomatic because of the lung. So this is the PDA of this baby. As you can see, it's a totally laminar flow. So little bit tubular PDA, little truncated. It's not a really regular long tubular PDA. It's a short tubular PDA. As you can see, there is enough space in the aorta and the left pulmonary artery for us to plan a catheter-based intervention. So this is a PDA on the day that we plan to do the device closure. You can see there is torrential flow across the PDA, and that's the anatomy. So here on the day that we attempted device closure, the duct measured 2.4 millimeters. So echo report shows large PDA, dilated LALV, LA aorta ratio 1.6, moderate TR was already there, severe hyperthermic pulmonary hypertension and moderate AS. Now, for any baby who comes into cath lab, whether PDA or non-PDA, all the small babies, so this is our protocol. In the ICU, all these things are taken care of: temperature, skin integrity, blood sugars, electrolyte, transport, airway maintenance. And in the cath lab, all these things are again rechecked. Temperature of the baby, fluoro settings are kept to the minimum, and neonatal settings. So we, in fact, remove the filters to allow us for better pictures. So lowest radiation setting is performed. Usually we take access under ultrasonic guidance. In this patient, as I mentioned, there was a lot of edema. So there was no way that we would have done this femoral venous access without ultrasonic guidance. We do have a ventilator in the cath lab for small babies because our anesthesia machines are not capable of giving very low ID volumes. Defibrillator settings are always rechecked and paddles are kept ready. We don't put the paddles on the baby as yet. Warm saline flushes are used regularly when we deal with very small babies. All the support drugs, emergency drugs are loaded and kept ready. So this is the preparation before we take we start the case in the cath lab. So in this case, we obtained a femoral venous access, 4 French, we did not take arterial access. PDA size, they measured 2.4 to 3.2. As we all know that there is some amount of stretchability of this PDA. Standard hardware what we use for these cases are Thermo guide wire, PPCA guide wire, 4 French GR 1.5 per catheter from Cook, 4 French Scott 2 amplexer sheet, and 4x4 ADO2 AS in view of this size of the PDA. So this is the beginning of the procedure. As you can see, the catheter is still there in the right atrium. Only the guide wire is crossing, and the guide wire crosses the ductus in this fashion. We do not manipulate any catheter in the right ventricle because newborn myocardium are very, very sensitive to catheter stimulus and develop VT immediately that we need to manipulate inside. Usually the flow takes the catheter into the sheath angiogram. So this is the standard fashion that we do sheath angiograms in these babies. The sheath is kept at the mouth of the PDA at the aortic end, and an angiography is done. So a 4 French Torque Tube sheet, which is recommended and supplied by the Amplexer company, is being used for all these babies. So as you can see, there's no arterial lining here. So we deployed a 4x4mm device in a standard fashion. So we extensively use lateral view angiograms, I mean lateral view fluoroscopy for deployment of the PDA. So we have confirmed that the pulmonary artery disc is well stable within the pulmonary artery here by doing a pulmonary artery injection. Apart from this, as I said, it's mandatory to perform a proper echo assessment before we release the device. So this was an echo assessment on the table. Here you can see there is significant residual flow in this PDA. So this is quite unusual. We usually do not see so much of residual flow in this PDA. But we kept on assessing. We waited for 10-15 minutes for this to subside. This is 10 minutes post deployment. You can see the cable is still there. We are waiting for this flow to subside. And as you can see, there's good deformity of the device, and the aortic end of the device is properly in position, and the pulmonary artery device end is also in proper position. So having seen this, we thought we are all safe and we release this device. Even release also, you can see there is not much movement of the device. So the device is rock stable. So this is the final release, and we were prepping to take the baby out. So this was a device position after the release, and this is immediately, within 5 minutes, the patient is still on table, the device has embolized. So this device embolism was first recognized on echo. Fluoroscopy is done after that. So now, what do we do now? This baby is only 820 grams. The size of the baby does not allow us to do too many heroics. Can't take any arterial access, but we still have a venous sheath inside. We have not taken out the 4 French venous sheath. Baby is hemodynamically stable, and we have standard hardware for retrieval of this device. Okay, so this is the echocardiography. Surprisingly, we see here that the size of the PDA has increased. 2.4 was what I showed before. Now this same PDA is measuring 3.3 millimeters. No wonder the 4 millimeter device embolizes. So even if we take it out, we'll have to be double careful what to do after this. So this is the position of the PDA device. It's in the origin of the right pulmonary artery. So next steps, we wanted to upgrade the sheet size to 5 French, but it's impossible to put a 5 French sheet in such a small baby. We could just insert the tip of a termo sheet only into the femoral vein and nothing beyond that. None of the 5 French catheters were able to pass into the venous system. The only option what we had was a 4 French diagnostic catheter, and we had a 10 mm Gooseneck snare, which was compatible with the 4 French catheter on the table. So the further plan was snare this out. We cannot capture this device into any of the catheters or the sheaths. So we have to bring it into the IVC and then take it into the 5 French groin sheath. So this is the most dangerous step in this baby, because we can damage tricuspid valve very significantly. So I have to be 100 times more careful when I'm actually taking the device across the tricuspid valve, avoiding any damage. So this is the retrieval sequence. Luckily, the device position is very stable. So again, this time we are planning to put a PTCRY. We are not taking the thermo guidewire because there was lots of arrhythmias this time when I took the thermo wire. So we have crossed the ductus and it will be resting through the aorta. The first picture here shows me taking the snare into the pulmonary artery and holding the device with a 10 mm Gooseneck snare. Luckily, this part of the procedure was very, very simple and straightforward, and this is the very first attempt that we got this device. So once I caught the device, we slowly took it out of the pulmonary artery across the pulmonary valve and the RV and the tricuspid valve and into the 5 French groin sheath, which was inserted here. So there was no much damage to the groin blood vessels. A repeat echocardiography showed no further increase in the amount of the TR from the previous, and we now deployed a 5x4 mm ADO2 AS. So after taking out the 4x4 mm ADO2 AS, so further confirmations of stable device position, and finally the release. So for us, this device has stayed well without any problem. So this is the 5x4 mm device. So this is a post deployment picture, echocardiography picture of 5x4. As you can see, there is no obstruction to either the left pulmonary artery or the aorta. So now the baby is doing well. To now it is nearly 1 month follow up. The second twin also is undergoing some problems. Baby has developed sepsis, the second twin, not this one, the other twin. So both the babies are still there. So today's weight is 984 grams, constant weight gain for past 3 days, and baby does not have any edema anymore. So the pulmonary arteries. Yeah. So the branch pulmonary artery flows are good, and the aortic flows are also good as well.
I think it's an amazing case, and I think a great save with a percutaneous technique, because that is one of the biggest problems of doing PDI closure in small babies. If you were to land in a problem like this, getting out of it is not as easy as one might think. And I think you have done a phenomenal job. The only comment I had, and which obviously was a concern in your mind also, was to get this device, which is not a covered device, across the pulmonary and, more importantly, the tricuspid valve. These babies have such delicate tricuspid valves that, you know, probably you need to say your prayers a couple of times more before getting it across the tricuspid valve without it being captured within a sheath.
Sir, you can connect.
Oh, yeah. Sir, actually, when we actually cross the tricuspid valve, Shivkumar sir was saying, if we go with a loop, either with the catheter or the guidewire, so there are less chances that you would go through the cardiac, but only less chances.
Not going through, getting the device
getting out also. Yes.
Getting the device
out, can connect.
Without it being in the sheath is a nightmare.
Only if this happens next time, I don't know what to do. Because of our sizing,
what you have done under the circumstances is amazing. Amazing outcome.
I use 980 gram, I did it 2 months back, in which I take the 4 French Mullen sheath all the way into the PA. So with the same Mullen sheath, probably you can retrieve it. So you need not with the 4 French Mullen sheath, take a 4 French RCA and then retrieve it and then get it into the sheath rather than bring it all the way towards the IDs. The 4 French
Torque sheath does not take 4 French Mullens are not.
Yeah, Mullins, it does. I think it's not enough time. I think we'll go into the next time. Edwin?
Yeah. Edwin, sir, you can share the screen.
Yeah. A very nice case. What to hear?
Oh, yeah.
Everything was one thing that the first device didn't have the Pac-Man sign. You know, all devices have Pac-Man sign to show stable device position. device didn't have Pacman sign, it means that the device is going to embolize. If you have a nice Pacman sign, it means that the device is holding within the PDA. You know, as the Pacman means, basically you see the Pacman video in the video game.
Yes, I understand. The separation of the discs have to be done.
The second device, you see the Pacman sign
nicely. Next is Dr. Anu from Lithi Hospital.
Yeah. Hi, good afternoon, everyone. So, just one second. Yeah. So, this is about a 15-day-old baby who was a precious child born 13 years after marriage. The baby was referred to us with history of poor feeding, cyanosis, and lethargy to rule out heart disease. And clinically, as you can see, the baby was quite blue, weighed around 2.7 kg. Saturation was around 65 to 70%. He had a faint systolic murmur and a single second sound. The echocardiography is quite evident, showed a minimal antegrade flows. And there was a small PDA, which was quite tortuous and not very well responsive to prostaglandin. So here we have a baby with tetralogy, a large coronoventricular VST, near pulmonary atresia, and severe TR, a tortuous long PDA to LP origin, which was slightly narrow. So the options available, of course, was a PDA stenting, RVOT stenting versus a BT shunt. And we thought of going ahead with intervention and not the BT shunt because given the mortality rate with neonatal BT shunts. And between RVOT stenting and PDA stenting, RVOT stenting was preferred because the ductus was tortuous, narrow, and to promote better PA growth. So took a femoral venous access, tried at crossing into the PA, but even after multiple attempts, we couldn't cross. Finally, when we did cross into the PA, the baby had complete heart block and hypotension. So we had to back off. We took a right IJV access. This time, crossing into the pulmonary artery was quite easy. The wire very easily went into the pulmonary artery, but unfortunate, the baby had a VT and decompensated, and we had to abort the procedure at this point of time. So again, what next is left for us? Send the baby for surgery or do another attempt at intervention. And we were quite tempted to go ahead with the second option because it was crossing into the PA from the right IJV access was quite easy, and we did think that if we could minimize manipulations, if we could do the procedure faster, we could get a good result. So with the motto of minimal manipulations, we did go ahead with the re-attempt option. So planning the procedure here was very important. Access, of course, the right IJV access. Hardware planning was what was quite important. We sat and thought about the catheter to be used. We decided to go ahead with a short renal double curve guide, which could be used instead of a sheath directly. We used the renal double curve guide to go in, and other hardware also was kept ready. And of course, plan B should also be ready. And we thought either PDA stenting or if possible, yeah, or to send the baby for surgery if this doesn't work out. So here we took the baby to the cath lab. On inotropic support, the baby did have stable hemodynamics. Heart rate was around 120, BP 70-40, and a saturation of 75%. The PA was crossed with the 025 termo wire. Here you can see the RDC guide sitting in place. We took it all the way in, and through over this wire, we took in a four French glide catheter. A PA injection was done. The glide, while sitting in the RVOT, caused further decompensation. The BP fell, heart rate fell. There was falling saturations further, but there was no go. So we took another V18 wire and pulled out the glide as soon as possible. Here we got, this time we couldn't cross into the branch PA. Instead, the wire took a very interesting course. It went in through the ductus into the carotid, left carotid artery. PA in through the PDA into the left carotid artery. We let that wire position remain. We did an attempt for another wire position. And over this wire, we took a four French diagnostic RCA catheter And again, as you can see, with the further injection, there is further drop in the vitals. The BP fell further, heart rate is low, and the saturations came to around 50%. Injection done here, you can see the ductus and the branch PA lighting up. Yeah, and over this RCA guide, the RDC guide was tracked inside. And with these two sitting in, there was further a fall in the saturation, the heart rate, as well as the blood pressure. And we took a guide injection to get the landmarks correct. And here we are uncertain about where the PDA and the PA borders are, not quite a clear injection. And another a very scary fact here is that the baby had a very low output. You can see the heart hardly contracting. The PDA is causing the ascending aorta to fill in this injection. So the output from the heart is quite low. The saturations became unrecordable. BP further plummeted. Heart rate was around 40. We were in a great soup. And at this point, when every second was counting what could go wrong, we were a little, in a very tight spot here. And we still now didn't have any RV injections. We didn't have RV injection. So we didn't have a clarity about where the lower end of the stent should be. So, and also another fact was that the wire was into the PDA. So there was a high risk that we could have stented the RVOT into the PDA, which would have been quite detrimental. And again, the big mistake, because since we didn't have an RV injection, there was no option. We did have to take an RV injection. And the baby's condition was not very stable. We didn't have the time to take the echo machine and do an echocardiography at this point. So we went ahead with the RV injection. And there is hardly any contraction. We still couldn't get a landmark regarding the upper end of the stent. But from the previous injections, yes, we did have an idea. Hardly any contractions. And at this point, the baby had a near cardiac arrest. There was complete occlusion of the RVOT because of the stent, which was sitting across the RVOT. Further manipulations in the ductus probably caused further ductal constriction, as well as stretching of the heart due to the hardware, all contributed in a near cardiac arrest at this point of time. And this is the deployment of the stent. So what we did here was, you can see that the wire, which was quite into the keratin, we have pulled the wire back quite a bit, and the tug on the wire was also let loose. You can see it's a floppy end that is into the ductus here. So this we thought would actually let the stent fall into the PA and would not cause stenting into the ductus. So we did have a good result with that, and later after some more stabilization, we got a good injection done. And now we can see how the heart is contracting really well. The TR, which was not seen earlier, can be seen here. And there is good anti-grade flows also. So this is an echocardiogram done on follow-up showing the stent position and good anti-grade flows. Concluding, RVOT stenting is possible, when possible, is superior to PDA stenting. And proper planning of the hardware is of utmost importance for a successful procedure. Thank you.
May I have comments?
Go ahead.
I saw there are some cases with RVOT stenting from India College, but in my practice, I don't try to advance the sheath or the guiding catheter through the RVOT to the PA because it's very risky. The patient is easy to be collapsed very soon. And so I just cross by the wire and advance the stent. The guiding catheter or the sheath just inside the RV, and we just use for doing angiography, or we keep the guiding catheter or the sheath for preventing the stent dislodge when we inflate the balloon. We don't try to process, because even though in the not severe cases, the RVOT is bottom, the patient also will collapse very soon.
I wanted to make one comment. And my comment was that many times when you have isolated valvar stenosis without there being a subvalve stenosis in the era prior to RVOT stenting, when I was, means I'm talking about maybe 20 years back, we have successfully done ordinary balloon pulmonary valvuloplasty and rescued many of these small babies from shunt as well as from getting into severe cyanotic spell. So I think looking at the anatomy and also entertaining ordinary balloon pulmonary valvuloplasty, which is a much less demanding procedure, one should consider that option also in these babies.
Thank you.
Dr. Rajesh.
Good morning, everyone. Able to see my screen?
Yes, very well.
Yeah. Thank you. First of all, I like to thank Dr. Shivakumar sir for giving me this opportunity, and apparently he is the chief operator for this case. So basically, this is a case of a retrograde dissection in a papery thin aorta in a case of middle aortic syndrome. So it's a 16-year-old female from the rural part of southern India, is actually admitted in other government centers, hypertensive encephalopathy, and the patient was referred here, and he was being treating in some other places with hypertensive encephalopathy without identifying the proper diagnosis, and the child is a non-syndromic girl. And apparently had an absent femoral pulses, and this was a upper limb BP. We recorded like a 220, 110 by 140, and the lower limb was a huge discrepancy of 140. And initial workup we have done, we had a cause of any coactation or a mass, a middle aortic syndrome. And initial workup showed a ESR of 15, and the CRP is negative, and counts were normal. And we had done the MAN2. We had a similar case of tuberculosis presenting as a middle aortic syndrome. And there was a talk of, thing about whether the MRI and PET scan, and the MRI has a limited sensitivity to rule out aortitis in the for the thing, and PET scan, it's not widely available. And these are also the some pros and cons of doing PET scan in the middle aortic syndrome, where not much data available. And anyway, this patient had a financial constraint, so we could not go ahead with the PET scan. And this is the X-ray having some cardiomegaly with LV dysfunction, and clearly showing LV strain. And we have done the CT. You can see the long narrow segment of thing which involved the diffuse involvement of proximal thoracic aorta with middle thoracic aorta also. And there was a narrow segment measures around 3 to 4 millimeter, and it was almost 2 centimeters below the left subclavian artery. And the total disease segment was measuring around 80 to 83 centimeters. So this made this final diagnosis as a middle aortic syndrome with a moderate LV systolic dysfunction of EF of 38%, and the child had a global longitudinal strain of LV strain around -12%. So this is a angiogram with the marker pictile. We can show the long disease segment with the mid thoracic aorta and involvement of the lower thoracic aorta also. And we have taken multiple measurements to choose our stent size. And initially we went with this 12x65. It's a silene covered stent. The reason is being chosen due to some logistic issues as well as some financial constraints. So we have chosen this stent, which is a cobalt chromium peripheral stent of 12x65 silene covered stent. It's a pre-mounted stent, and the initial deployment was having, there was some narrowing of the waist was present, and there was some gradient across this narrow portion. We were not happy about this gradient. We got 30 to 40 gradient, and this was a post-stent angiogram initially. And you can see this waist in the both in the lateral and AP view. So we wanted to further dilate with the 12x4 Mustang balloon, and we got some reduction of the waist, but still the results were not completely very good, because we just still were able to got a gradient across the thing. So we decided to use the another stent of 57 Andra XL we took, and we have mounted over the 12x4 millimeter atrus balloon, and we have positioned the stent across this waist segment, and we were able to get a good control position. So after that post deployment angiogram, everything we thought, there's no gradient across the thing, everything we thought very fine actually. So then we wanted to confirm with the angiogram, so we went to the marker pictile. Then you can see this is the cause of this thing. This is having the retrograde aortic dissection. We entered the pictile through the false lumen, and then we took the pictile out, and then we recrossed the true lumen. So there was a definitely a retrograde aortic dissection, which was shown here. So, but looking at the hemodynamics, we got the basal pressure of 230, and we came to 160, and there was not much post
Android deployment, there's no significant gradient, but there was some upper limb discrepancy in the pulse, and there was some 20 gradient across the right upper limb and left upper limb. So there was some concern whether this dissection would have involvement in the left subclavian artery. So what to do next? And this is, we just want to make sure there's any descending aorta check angiogram, any dissection in the descending aorta. So, but we haven't any gross dissection has been shown. So what to do next? Only two options, whether to intervene or not. If hemodynamically significant and there is a progression of blood, we need to intervene because it will enroach the branch vessels and then it will cause some hemodynamic compromise. And possible options will be a stent graft using or even the surgery of taking out the dissection and all this, which is a very messy procedure and it needs a lot of gadgets available also. So then we have decided to went with the CT and this thing, and we can able to see there are some partial dissection and it's not a complete dissection though. And we were make sure it is a retrograde dissection only because the antegrade dissection means there was suggest there can be a progression of flap flap for that. Since a retrograde dissection, the flap might subside in the future because of the high SVR and high hypertension. So we thought we'll decide to follow up, and this follow up CT have done. We found there's a nice position of this stent and everything was there still. So we thought what could be the done in this patient. So the balloon angioplasty and stenting in this critically concluded occluded segment in the middle aortic syndrome is very challenging because of the extensive panarteritis. And in contrast to the arthromatous disease, this is very little elastic tissue with higher incidence of dissection. And the retrograde dissection has higher chance of spontaneous resolution, but needs careful observation in the follow-up. Not only the stent and balloon, even the routine hardwares like thermowire, guide catheter can cause dissections in these situations. So whether retrograde dissection need to be intervened or not, if so, what are the indication? Is negative markers, which we are routinely doing, all the only reassuring factor to go ahead in these conditions? Are we having ideal hardwares for these conditions? So these are the messages which needs to be understood, especially dealing with this middle aortic syndrome. And thanks for listening.
I think it's a quite an unusual complication, although well reported in literature. My question to you is, as to what do you think has caused this dissection? I'm not sir, sure. Because sir, it's very close to the stent and it is little distally. So I'm not sure what actually caused it.
Sir, actually, we also not sure because after we deployed the Andrasten, we want to make, we took out this stiff wire and then we put the marker pigtail. Whether the stiff wire, what caused or even this marker pigtail caused this thing, we were not able to get it actually. We went through this previous angios. So even a smaller, even the guide wire must have caused or so that was a guide catheter must have caused or we were not very sure. So that's what the reason we thought. Even negative markers, not a reassuring factor. Even the there's not much literature in Western where people were doing that inversion recovery sequence of MRA were not showing much sensitivity. So probably the PET scan will have role of patchy aortitis and something like that. But still, it's not a reassuring factor to go ahead even with the safe gadgets what we are having now.
I completely agree with you. And I don't think that there is anything like ideal for this particular situation. But yes. One of the important lessons for aortoarthritis is this is a classical example where you can say that the worst enemy of good is better. You have to underdo rather than overdo, and you can do it in a staged fashion. Sometimes you may accept a little residual gradient rather than going for a perfect shot. So that is another thing that is important in these patients with aortoarthritis.
Yes, sir, I'll accept. Yeah. Yes.
Next speaker and final speaker for the day, Neeraj.
Yeah, Dr. Neeraj, you can.
Yeah, I can start now.
Yeah, please.
Okay, so I will present my case. It's a very simple case compared to all the previous cases.
You've not started the PPT.
Sorry, you can see the PPT?
No, the PPT. You're not seeing the PPT.
No, I'm seeing it.
Yeah, just double click on that. We are only seeing the file.
Okay.
Or make it
how?
Can't see.
Not yet.
You're still seeing that sharing screen.
Sorry. Sharing screen, but I have shared. I don't know what to do.
I just like to stop it, like, and then you can share it once again.
Okay.
But now you can share.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will share my case, which is very simple VSD closure turned into a complication. The 4-year-old child with 12 kg weight failed to thrive. Echo showing 4 to 5 mm VSD, and in our unit we do this markers, platelets, PTFE in all cases before the care. Routine protocol: vascular access, heparin bolus 100 per kg, and LV angiogram. Routine LV angiogram showing a VSD, PM VSD. Yeah. Retrograde technique, and VSD is crossed by the O32 wire. 5 French JR guiding catheter and 802 was deployed. Echo was showing good results and ECG was sinus rhythm. We thought we could deploy it. Before deploying, we thought Charcot angiogram, and I thought it's looking good to me. I'll go to the next slide now. And device was released. Total procedure time from heparin bolus to device release was 25 minutes only. But as soon as I released the device, I saw something coming to this part. This one. I was not sure what is happening here, but I could see a contrast enhanced mass like structure in the ascending aorta. We thought, let's see the echo. Echo was showing not resolution, but we could see a mass in the ascending aorta. Further profiling showed, looks like a, I thought it's a thrombus only. This thrombus probably was originating from the device screw, but I was not sure. We gave a repeat bolus of heparin. My catheter was inside already. I thought, let us try the experience of thrombus. Under echo guidance, we could aspirate the thrombus, which was confirmed on the bench that is a thrombus only. I could remove the thrombus. Echo was done at 1 hour, 4 hours, and 24 hours. There was no thrombus. Ascending aorta was clean. There was no AR. Retrospective analysis of the root angiogram is very critical here. See this mass? When I was about to release the device, I missed this part. You can see the arrow. This is the mass. Thrombus probably attached to the guiding catheter. And when I released the, when I put the screw into the guiding catheter, the thrombus passed out. Follow-up has been done till 5 years. It was 5 years back the case was done. No neurological event, no thrombus. And subsequent prothrombotic workup was normal. I don't know why this happened, but we saw a thrombus in the ascending aorta. Last slide, possibly I say ACT levels in all cases, which we do nowadays, and we try to control the ACT levels in all cases. The study we could found where you can have a factors influencing ACT after IV bolus of 100 units per kg in pediatric cases, 2017 clinical and applied thrombosis series. They say when you give a heparin bolus of 100 units per kg, to achieve a target of ACT of 160-240, only 70% will have the acute targets. 30% will not achieve the target. So how many heparin bolus should be given in any case is totally unpredictable, and probably we should care about it. Thanks.
Excellent. I think it was quite a learning lesson, but I think still most of the centers, at least in pediatric laboratories, don't do ACT as a routine. But I think this is a classical example. Despite adequate heparinization, despite the procedure timing being short, despite there not being multiple exchanges of catheters, we have ended up with this problem. Fortunately, it didn't embolize in the cerebrovascular circulation. Otherwise, you know, the outcome could have been quite disastrous. Thank you for sharing your experience. And in the interest of time, I would like to close this session. I would like to thank all the participants. I know that a couple of them have not been able to present their cases, but we assure you that we will be asking you to present your cases during our next edition of this program. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Shiva, to thank Muthu and Edwin, and of course, last but not the least, Dr. Tin, for having spent so much of his valuable time with all of us here. And I thank all the participants for showing their enthusiasm in making this edition of Learning from the Masters, this entire session of congenital heart interventions. We assure you that we'll be coming back, but not with so many editions of this particular program. There may be one or two programs every week that Satya will communicate with you. Thank you all. Stay safe and stay healthy. and with that we will conclude. Thanks, Satya. If you have any comments or any announcements to make, please go ahead.
Dr. Tin and Dr. Shivakumar, if we have any comments.
Thanks a lot. It's running quite late, and Dr. Tin, your comments, and then we can close.
Yeah, just say thank you for everybody. Satya, you're doing the great job, and the chance for everybody to share experience, learn together. Thank you again.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. So can I close the session, sir?
Please.
Right, sir.
Nghĩ Việt Nam mình có thể làm được. Cuối cùng ngừa cái đó là không phải cái đó. Tại tụi nó nói mình phải dùng cái guiding creator mà cái sang hô. Tại khi em dùng cái mà vessel creator là từ trên xuống như này thả xong á, có cái cáp bộ ở trong.
Yeah.
Thì cái khối động đó em bơm, cái khối từ dài một đoạn dài mà.
Yeah.
Em phải bơm vô đến động đó. Tốt nhất là phải cho nó thông, thông á, tại vì nó có một đầu ra thôi.
Yeah.
Có gai đi vai rồi cái dù nó nằm nó không ra, nếu mà có lỗ bên á, đó là cái cây đinh có lỗ bên sai hô nó chạy ra chạy vô liên tục á thì nó sẽ không bị, chứ không phải là cái lỗi này của cho hairpin, cái lỗ này tất cả có hairpin nhưng mà trong cái ống để lâu nó cũng bị nữa, cái ống mà trong